The Royal Society of Tropical Medicine and Hygiene welcomes you to this online event, which comes to you live from the Royal Society in London. Today's topic is the Disease Elimination Agenda, the role of science, policy and advocacy. This event will explore the role of policy making, recent advances in disease control and elimination, and in agenda setting beyond the Millennium Development Goals. Our programme starts at 9:20 a.m. with a welcome address, followed at 9:35 by a presentation by Professor David Molyneux from Liverpool School of Tropical Medicine titled Eradication, Elimination and Control: Public Health Policy Implications, Semantics or Reality. At 10 a.m. we will hear from Dr. Guillaume Chabot-Couture from the Institute of Disease Modelling, who will discuss polio eradication and the challenges in approaching zero cases. At 10:20, we will welcome Virginia Serra from the International Coalition for Trachoma Control, who will give a presentation about closing the gap on blinding trachoma. At 10:40, we will hear from Professor Charles Mackenzie from Liverpool School of Tropical Medicine, who will discuss the lymphatic filariasis elimination programme. At 11 a.m, we will take a short break, followed by a presentation at 11:30 by Professor David Smith from the Scenario Institute for Global Health and Tropical Medicine, who will reflect on malaria eradication in the past, present and future. Finally, at 11:50, we will be joined by Professor Chris Whitty from London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine, who will discuss the political and technical pitfalls in eradication attempts. We will now go live to the Royal Society in London for today's meeting.
So the first thing I'd like to do for all of you that want connections while you're listening to things today and hopefully tweeting about us, you should go onto RS Network. And the password for that is Newton with a capital N plus Apple with no spaces. So if you've got any problems with that, I'll repeat it after the introductions. So welcome to our inaugural policy focus meeting today, which will do two things. It will first set the framework for a discussion at the Royal Society on what our position as a society should be on eradication. And we'll also provide the framework for a longer meeting next September, our biennial, which is also themed on eradication. So we're going to learn a lot today and use that to shape our biennial. The morning sessions today are being live streamed, and I'd like to welcome all the people from overseas. So they include KEMRI, the Kenyan Medical Research Institute, the Mectizan Donation Program, colleagues all over Africa, the NTD Non-Governmental Development Organization Network, which goes by NNN, with colleagues all over the world, and the University of Oxford research units in Kenya, Malawi, Vietnam and Thailand. There may well be some others, and I apologize if we have not recognized you there. These morning sessions are also all the presentations are all being filmed and will be on our YouTube channel by next week. The program details and speaker profiles are all and abstracts are all now on our meeting app. So now that you all have your internet connections, you can download that, and an email will send to you all about that. If you are unable to do those, come and see us during the break and we will help you download those. We also today are launching our theme issue of international health on disease elimination in support of this meeting. And also we're providing a web collection online which brings together both some of the publications in there and former seminal works in our journals. These will be freely available until the end of November, and of course always freely available if you're a fellow. So please sign up today if you're not. I'm not going to speak for too long because I imagine I'll have a bit of a challenge with some of our speakers, keeping them all to 20 minutes. And we have four of them this morning before a break, and then another two before a panel discussion. So what we're going to do is, depending on how long people take, I'll probably allow one or two questions after each talk. But if you can hold on to any of the longer discussions or things that need drawing out, we'll bring those together in the panel discussion before lunch, where we have half an hour, and we'll bring all the speakers after the break. We'll bring a table up here and have a panel discussion where we can draw out any of the themes that have come up in the morning. I will not talk any longer, but welcome you to this meeting and invite our first speaker up, and it's a delight to do so, Professor David Molyneux from the Liverpool School of Tropical Medicine. And he will talk to us about eradication, elimination and control, public health and policy implications, semantics or reality, and will keep us all using the nomenclature correctly all day, I hope. David.
Is there a Okay. Good morning here, good afternoon in Asia, and good night elsewhere. First of all, it's a privilege to be asked to start the ball rolling on this really important meeting. The topic and the title is, for me, really challenging. And I've been involved in this area for some years. I deliberately chose controversial titles, both in the terms of this presentation and in terms of the editorial I was invited to produce for this important international health series. Now, I'm going to start by referring you back to what I consider the Bible on eradication of diseases. In the late 1990s, and in this book you can see what the criteria are for the definition and the aspiration of eradication. This followed, of course, the successful eradication of smallpox, which is, I have to remind you, is the only successful eradication that has been achieved by the public health community. The failures include yellow fever, malaria, and yours. Now, Don Hopkins, in this book, identified 10 criteria which needed to be addressed if you were considering eradication. Some of them include understanding the natural history of the organism you're dealing with, wide consultation before you embark on a program, the importance of surveillance, the requisite vertical approach for the target infection, being open-minded and aware that you're going to face challenges of various sorts and expect the unexpected. What I believe also really importantly is that you need strong advocacy, not necessarily from scientists but from politicians, as demonstrated by the exceptional advocacy of Jimmy Carter. Amongst other things, the Disease Eradication Task Force, which was the result of that publication, identified 6 diseases which they considered to be eradicable. And in the mid-2000s, with Don Hopkins and Nevio Zagaria, I wrote this paper which emphasized the need for accurate and consistent usage of the terminology of eradication, elimination, and control. The 6 diseases which the task force in the early 1990s considered were eradicable were guinea worm, trachoculiasis, polio, cysticercosis, rubella, lymphatic filariasis, and mumps. That may have changed over the last decade or so, but this was the basis for the furthering of certainly the guinea worm and the polio eradication programs. This has not come up too well, but just want to emphasize the eradication terminology and definition. And I think you should frame this meeting along these lines. Permanent reduction to 0 worldwide incidence of infection caused by a specific agent as a result of deliberate efforts. Intervention measures are no longer required. I do want to emphasize global and infection, not disease. Those are addressed in the definitions of elimination of disease and infection, which are listed above. But you can get that from WHO publications and other literature. But WHO, in its excellent reports on neglected tropical diseases, have used those terms in their publications. But within a month of those publications, the weekly epidemiological record used exactly the wrong terminology, the eradication of yours in India. It should have been elimination of yours in India, because eradication is global and must be certified by a formal commission and a formal process. Now, I'm going to use a few examples, which I have some experience with, about the problems and challenges of eradication. First of all, guinea worm. This is the slide from WHO sources, and Dirk Engels is here and can supplement the most up-to-date information. But this was 2014. Numbers of reported cases in 4 countries were 126. The information we have up to this time of year, I think, is less than about 20 so far this year in 4 countries. I'll discuss those 4 countries. But I was in part of the certification team which visited Nigeria. One of the really important things about the Nigeria experience of guinea worm is that it got down from 680,000 cases in 1988 to 0 cases 20 years later. The biggest, most populous country in Africa, in 6,000 villages across the spectrum of the ecologies in Nigeria. That was a huge public health success. It was due to many factors. But like many of the diseases we're going to be talking about, sensitization of the population and the reward system in Nigeria was critical. It associated with a really effective surveillance procedure, which involved the guinea worm eradication program as well. So these experiences are important in terms of us being able to move forward. Now in guinea worm, our trajectory has been somewhat derailed by what has been described by Mark Eberhard and colleagues in Chad as a peculiar epidemiology. Up to 4 years ago, we had no idea that dogs would be involved in the cycle in Africa. Some 15 countries had been certified free of guinea worm transmission in Africa, and there had never been a sighting or a case reported in dogs. Mark Eberhard's search of the literature suggests that the last record of that was in Uzbekistan in 1932. But suddenly, dogs became evident, and you can see here, I'm not sure what I'm going to touch, but bottom right, an emerging, classic guinea worm emerging from a dog. Initially, small numbers of dogs were found to be infected, but up to date this year, 2015, the numbers that have been detected of guinea worm cases in dogs are approaching, if not in excess, of 400, whilst there have been only 7 human cases. And those human cases are scattered, as you see from the 19, this is 2015 figures, the yellow squares are human cases. They do not fit the epidemiology we know of infection in Chad. The worrying thing about the Chad situation, excepting there may be an entirely different life cycle involving a paratenic host in the fish, associated with the fishing of the lagoons in the Chari River as the water levels decline, there is something strange happening here. If 400 cases of dog guinea worm have been discovered by August, the rate of increase in the dog population of this infection is extremely concerning. What we do about it, we don't know. But for me, the worrying thing is the cases on close to the human cases close to the border with the RCA, République Centrafricaine, because that country has already been certified free of transmission. And you'll see the numbers of dog cases in blue coming down the river system. Another problem we face, and this relates to Nigeria, during the ICT mission to Nigeria 2 years ago, Boko Haram in the northeast of Nigeria shot 30 children and burnt down a school. We know the story of Boko Haram, which dominates that area. We were only able to verify transmission had stopped in the northeast of Nigeria in that very narrow window of opportunity because we had some brave people from Nigerian NGOs who were prepared to go into Bornu under the radar screen. UN people cannot go to these areas now. And 3 people have been killed in the last year working on guinea worm missions in Niger and more recently too in Sudan. So guinea worm, with the endemic countries Mali, Chad, South Sudan and Ethiopia, we face a challenge. We have dramatically reduced the numbers of cases. But as in all eradications, the last mile is the big challenge, and the emergence of the dogs in Chad pose a significant problem in terms of the definition of eradication. Zero global incidence of infection, Dracunculus medinensis. Not just in humans, doesn't specify whether it's in dogs or humans or whatever. We also know in Chad that a wild carnivore has been detected with a guinea worm. I'll leave you that question mark hanging over the term eradication. in the context of guinea worm as we face it now. But Mali has endemic areas in insecure parts of northern and eastern Mali. Chad presents its peculiar epidemiology. South Sudan is actually going to be successful. Been a fantastic decline in numbers in South Sudan despite the civil unrest. And in Ethiopia we have an isolated area around Gambela where whilst there are one or two cases still, we have had dogs and baboons seen to be infected. Now, guinea worm program needs to launch, like smallpox did in the 1970s, a global reward. And this is the smallpox poster. And we will need, for the guinea worm eradication program, a global reward for reporting any new case. Now, I want to track back to a bit of history. Iceland. Now, this is a journal which you're all familiar with, the International Journal of Osteoarchaeology. Up to date, 2010, cases of Hydatid disease in medieval Iceland. These are the Hydatid cysts, and you see in the arrow in the bottom right, a Hydatid cyst in a corpse excavated in a monastery in Iceland in recently, dating back to about 1300, 1400. If you want to know what Iceland was like when the first elimination program was started by a Danish vet, Dr. Harold Krabber, you need to read Burial Rites by Hannah Kent, which describes the situation, a novel, the last execution of a female Icelander for murder in 1830. Fantastic book, but it sets the scene of rural Iceland. And this is the two documents, Harold Krabber, how you eliminate, and I'm using the word correctly, a disease and infection from an island. Reviewed by Johansson. Now, your Icelandic is probably worse than mine, but the point about this document on the left of your screen was that Krabber circulated this to all the communities in Iceland, which was a highly literate society and could only read the Bible and the Icelandic sagas. So when they got a document on something else, they read it avidly. And that was the basis for sensitizing the population of Iceland to remove Hydatid disease using purging dogs, appropriate use and destruction of sheep carcasses, and health education. But that process took 25 to 30 years to get Hydatid disease down to zero cases. Now, the point about that was it was not endemic in Iceland until dogs were moved into Iceland by the Germans in about 1300, and hence the Hydatid cysts in those excavated corpses. I want to move on to onchocerciasis. At the end of this year, two of the most successful public health programs, and Adrian Hopkins will talk about them, will stop. But I want to emphasize what the original objectives of those programs were. The onchocerciasis control program in West Africa was the control of onchocerciasis as a problem of public health importance and as an impediment to socioeconomic development. The APOC program, which followed it in 1995, the control of onchocerciasis to a point where it is no longer a disease of public health importance. And then in the Americas, the objective was the regional elimination, the correct term, of onchocerciasis. And since over a 25-year period using twice a year ivermectin, Colombia, Ecuador, and Mexico have been verified free of transmission. In West Africa, onchocerciasis left devastation like this, abandoned villages on rivers. This is a slide taken by an old colleague, David Baldry, of a village just outside Ouagadougou. And David is talking to them on the left of the picture. Not a single adult male in this picture had sight. 40 years later, nobody in West Africa is going to go blind or get skin disease from onchocerciasis. Whilst there may be microfilaria circulating still in a few residual foci, the disease has been controlled as a disease of public health importance throughout that continent, that part of the continent, and it will continue to be so. The last microfilaria may not have gone, and it was based initially on helicopter spraying, but then on ivermectin. And those are the achievements, and they're published in many journals of the onchocerciasis control programs, and they are something to celebrate. We may not have seen the last microfilaria, but actually, does that matter? Because nobody is going to go blind or get skin disease. But the scenario and paradigm changed when a paper in Mali demonstrated, from Mali and Senegal, demonstrated that you could achieve elimination using ivermectin alone. So the program changed not from the control and sustainability of ivermectin and controlling public health importance, but to elimination of onco on the continent of Africa. The question, and I think Adrian might address it, did we set the bar too high? In the Americas, we see that there's been a successful program based on ivermectin alone, and as I said, Mexico, Ecuador, and Colombia have had the absence of transmission verified. The problem lies down on the Venezuelan-Brazilian border, where suddenly, and this is the problem of access, 5,000 Yanomami have been discovered in the endemic area. Now, these are communities which are remote, very difficult to access, and therefore very difficult to give ivermectin on a regular basis because they move around, they're in a cross-border focus, and they are really out of contact with any health service. So that is one of the issues we really have to address. Now, I'm coming to the end, but the final point I want to make, and this is the island of Bioko, where onchocerciasis was a significant public health problem, but where, with ivermectin on the one hand, and then aerial spraying of the breeding sites of a particular vector species, the Bioko form of Simulium yahensi, which is genetically different from the mainland yahensi, this organism, this fly, has been made extinct. It doesn't exist on the planet anymore. That was the situation that was the aspiration of the smallpox program, and actually is the aspiration of the guinea worm program, had we not found guinea worm in the dogs. So there is a distinction between extinction, eradication, and elimination. So my take-home message is please use the terminology correctly. Eradication is zero global incidence of an infectious agent, not a disease. Therefore, this is controversial, you cannot eradicate malaria. You either eradicate falciparum, vivax, nolzai, etc. So if you're going to target eradication of a malaria organism, you better decide which one you take. So I believe anything that says eradication of malaria is terminologically incorrect. This is a long-term commitment. The ONCO program, achieving public health elimination, has been 40 years. Iceland took the same sort of time, as did New Zealand and Tasmania and Cyprus, to get rid of hydatid disease. Elimination is a regional or geographic context. WHO are seeking to eliminate dog-mediated rabies transmission in the Americas, for example. We've seen the geographic context in terms of islands, and I think you need to expect surprises. We have the biological surprise of the dogs. We have the sociogeographic discovery of unknown Yanomami communities. We have issues around political commitment and resource constraints, but we have conflict issues. Many of the areas where we will need to certify the eradication or the cessation of transmission of guinea worm are not currently accessible if you're anything to do with the United Nations. And there's a swathe of conflict across North Africa through to Pakistan, as we see for the polio eradication problems in Pakistan, through the northern parts of Sahel, from Mali through to Somalia. Islands are easy to eradicate or eliminate from. WHO leadership is critical, partnerships, alliance, and advocacy essential, in parallel with operational and implementation essential research. Research is essential, but it has to be directed within the context of the program. Onchocerciasis program succeeded because a significant budget was allocated to operational implementation research. And as I think Laura Dean will say this afternoon, don't expect magic bullets. They take a long time to fire and come to fruition. Now, thank you for the opportunity of talking to you. I'd like to acknowledge various people who contributed to the slides, Mark Eberhard and Frank Richards, and I wish the rest of the day well in discussing what I consider a really important issue and one which will engage the public health community for many years to come. Thank you.
Seems I'm going to have to get up and down quite a bit today. We're well on time, so David, are you happy to answer a couple of questions?
You've
been very good. So
That's a credit.
Yeah. Any questions, please? Now I've got you up. There'll be no hands coming up. There you go, Judy.
Thank you very much. That was fascinating, and I was very interested. My background, I'm not And I was very interested that you mentioned how animals relate with the human communities there. By the way, you didn't mention rinderpest, which has also been eradicated.
Well, this is has it? Because the virus lives in buffalo.
All right. That wasn't my question, and we can talk about that. But I wonder whether you think that the role, that the interface between the medical and veterinary professions in terms of delivery of this could be improved. Thank you very much. I wonder whether you think that that's a satisfactory interface at the moment, or whether it could be improved, and what sort of improvements, what sort of approaches could be taken to improve it?
I absolutely agree. You've only got, I mean, I'm not an expert in this area, and Bernadette Abdel is here from WHO. We have the tools here. We have rabies vaccination in dogs. We have the work that is being done on sleeping sickness in Uganda, where the joint approach between the Ministry of Health and the Ministry of Agriculture, treating cattle, which are the reservoir of DCNC, and spraying the cattle, they're brilliant examples of One Health and the interface. And the problem is, we know it works, but we can't find anybody to finance it. And also the issue, and I was involved with the WHO TDR zoonotic diseases report. We outlined what the issues were in that, and that's really how you make the sectors work together, be it livestock, agriculture. It can apply to water and sanitation, as I'm sure Yellerman would intervene about. And those are the issues. How can we bring these communities together to advocate for something which is going to be of benefit both in terms of livestock on the one hand and human health on the other? And that's the trick, and I think it's going to be addressed this afternoon in the session. But I think that the examples of rabies and sleeping sickness actually are very good ones. The interventions are there. The interventions are based on intervening with the animals, but really do make an impact, as we've seen from studies in KwaZulu-Natal, in Bali, and in the Americas. So yes, but.
Any more questions? And can I ask you, when you do have a question today, if you could wait for the microphone. Some of you got very nice loud voices, but people on the live stream won't be able to hear you if you don't speak into the microphone. David.
Hello. I wanted to follow up on this terminology discussion a bit, because you said that this infectious agent that was unique to Bioko Island has now gone extinct. So wouldn't that be, by your definition, another eradication success?
The agent, it was the fly that's been made extinct, not the agent that... Okay.
I thought there was a... You didn't say there was a parasite that was...
Well, the parasite has disappeared. Well, it's transmission of Onchocerca volvulus on Bioko has stopped because the fly has been made extinct. There is no reinvasion from the mainland of Bioko Island. Okay, so if the fly is gone, transmission has stopped. There will be some microfilaria left on Bioko, of that I am sure, but they will decline to zero because transmission has stopped over a period of 15 years probably. There are three cases that I'm aware of where the Onchocerciasis control program made a genetically distinct simulium disappear. One was a Jodgy form in Benin. The Bioko was another example. And I think a fly in Sierra Leone, which was named Simulium leonense, also disappeared. We also have examples of Simulium nevi in West Africa, populations which were isolated and probably genetically unique, made extinct. They were the vectors of the organism. I don't think you can call an insect an infectious agent. It is transmitting an agent. So the terminology here is, in my view, correct. The extinction of an insect population has to be viewed in another way. And as our colleague who asked the first question, I have a problem with the suggestion that rinderpest has been made extinct, if you use that definition, because the virus circulates in buffalo and other wild ungulates. So the entomological community, the veterinary community, and the public health community use the terminology in a different way and ignore each other.
Okay, so on that note, I'd like to thank David again and invite our next speaker, Dr. Guillaume Chabu-Coutre from the Institute of Disease Modeling, to talk to us today on polio eradication challenges in approaching zero cases.
Good morning, everyone. As Simon said, my name is Guillaume. I'm from Seattle. I work at the Institute for Disease Modeling. I used to be a physicist not so long ago, and 5 years ago, I started working for IDM and worked on a variety of diseases. The one that I work most on has been polio, but my colleagues also work on HIV, malaria, tuberculosis. So it's only a small part of what the Institute does, and there's so many people working on polio that this is just the part about disease modeling and eradication. It's always good to give a little bit of context, even though many of you may already be very familiar with polio. Separating the infections from the disease is perhaps most important in this case, because a very, very small fraction of all the infections actually cause disease. In most cases, if you are infected with polio, you might not even realize it. You might have no symptoms at all. And in less than one out of every 200 infections, approximately, you'll have a form of paralysis, which is poliomyelitis. As you can see on the right, there are two examples of what this paralysis can be. At the top, you have these iron lungs. One of the forms of paralysis is a paralysis of your breathing muscles. And in this case, to be kept alive, they needed a ventilator. In other places, there's no access to such technology, so paralysis of the breathing muscles would cause death. And here you have some examples of polio-caused paralysis in the DRC. So The agent of the disease is the poliovirus. It's an enterovirus that is transmitted from hand to hand to mouth. You can excrete it in your feces, or you can excrete it through your pharynx if you're infected. There are three serotypes that are named 1, 2, and 3. That distinction is important because you have really three different types of virus, and you need to have immunity to all three types to be protected against paralysis. I introduced this notion of case to infection ratio. That is the fraction of all infections that cause disease. The ones that causes the most disease is type 1, where you have 1 out of every 200, or 0.5% of cases. 0.5% of infections are cases. Whereas for type 2, it's more 1 out of every 2,000 infections. And for type 3, it's in between. There are two types of vaccines that exist. A vaccine based on killed viral particles that was licensed for the first time in 1955, the Salk vaccine. The difficulty with this vaccine is you get great serum immunity, but your mucosal immunity, your gut immunity, is not as good as caused as created by the live vaccine. The Sabin vaccine is an attenuated live vaccine. There you can get great immunity. It's easy to administer. It's administered through giving drops of a liquid in the mouth, so you can use it effectively in mass campaigns, which is more difficult for the killed vaccines. But in areas where you have a lot of antiviral pathology, your vaccine will be less effective. And this is perhaps most important when you get very close to the end. In rare cases, the vaccine actually can cause paralysis. If you 1 out of every 500,000 person that gets the vaccine can get paralyzed by the vaccine directly. And in certain cases, the vaccine can even start to circulate within a community and cause paralysis. So to give a very brief history of polio eradication, I thought I'd put together a simple graph for you that summarizes the total number of countries that report cases per the WHO database. That's the blue curve. The estimated number of cases globally is the green curve. You'll notice that I give an estimate of 500,000 infections in 1980, but at the time the number of reported cases was in the 40,000. So there's a lot of underreporting in the 80s, and at the time they were doing surveys to estimate incidence. Now, as of September, there's approximately 49 cases globally. All of this year, all of type 1, all of wild type 1. So I'm not, this actually includes the circulating vaccine derives as well. So to move through the timeline, in 1974, the expanded program for immunization was established. So they start to give the vaccine against polio in Africa, for example. In the 80s, the Americas is making a lot of progress controlling polio, and in 1985 starts their own polio elimination program from that region. And they're making a lot of progress, and it convinces the world that polio eradication can be done. So in 1988, the World Health Assembly makes a resolution to eradicate polio from the world, and to do so by the year 2000. So 12 years to get to the last case of wild polio and certification, which was a very ambitious goal, and turned out to be, polio eradication turned out to be much more difficult than anticipated. As you can see, a lot of progress was made right before the deadline in 2000. A lot of countries stopped having cases reported. The number of cases worldwide decreased. But it was followed by a period in the 2000 where a lot of countries became reinfected. There were outbreaks outside of the kind of the foci countries. And that took quite a while to resolve. In fact, I added a line, which is the number of endemic countries in red, which are these quote-unquote very most difficult countries, Nigeria, the India, the Pakistan. And now I'm being a little bit optimistic. I said in 2015 there were only two left. That's because Nigeria is on the verge of being taken out from the list of endemic countries. It's gone more than a year without wild poliovirus. You'll also notice that I indicated two dates, 1999 from the last of all the wild type 2 viruses, and 2012 for the last of all type 3 wild polioviruses. And that distinction is important. Is it you can have poliovirus that circulates and paralyzes, but can be derived from the vaccine, or can be derived from, can be wild in this case. So to give an idea, a brief idea of all the challenges and how difficult it is or it has been to eradicate polio, I thought I'd use a slide from the CDC that shows the number of outbreaks that took place just between 2002 and 2005 outside of these endemic countries. You'll notice that at the time, Nigeria, Niger, Egypt, and Afghanistan, Pakistan, India were endemic countries, countries that had never interrupted polio. Ever. That is, since the dawn of time, they had polio. And all the countries in green were countries where transmission was reestablished, that had been interrupted, and then these outbreaks reestablished transmission in those countries, so they had to fight it again in those countries. And I've noted a number of years on the slide that indicate the number of these outbreaks that they had to not only fight the disease in these endemic countries, but also fight it outside. In addition to a number of issues of vaccine refusals, inaccessibility, unrest, difficult to reach communities that made this segment of the campaign very difficult to make progress in. And one of the big issues with a program that needs to fight a disease on many fronts is that it costs a lot of money. There was a major impact in the 2000 on the finances. In the year 2000, the global budget for polio was about $400 million. And in the following 10 years, that figure increased almost up to $1 billion. And that is the roughly the burn rate, as of now, of polio eradication. And what's difficult is if you're trying to raise money every year, if you face a budget shortfall, you may have to cancel vaccination efforts, which increases your risk for further outbreaks, which may increase your need for further funding. So in 2012, there was a realization that there needed to be fundraising of the bulk amount that would allow the program to operate until the end and have no more of these funding shortfalls. So at the time, they were able to raise $4 billion out of an estimated $5.5 billion needed to finish. Now that this figure is increased up to $7 billion, which if complete would have a total cost eradication of $17 billion. You'll notice that the estimated benefit is still much greater than the cost to eradicate. But that's always provided that you're able to reach that. So there's always a chance that the program fails and that money was not as productive as it could have been. You'll also notice that this graph is a little bit cynical because I'm showing not only the expenditures for each of these years, but also the projected expenditures that the program estimated for each of these years. And each of these years, they thought the following year was going to be the most expensive. And right after that, their cost was going to decrease. And year over year, they realized this had to be pushed back. So that decade was a decade of realization of the difficulty, I think, in my opinion, of eradication and of the growing costs. So I want to give a couple of examples of how science can help and be useful for eradication programs, starting with kind of the efforts that are that happen within a program to manage the risk at the continental scale. Right. I've just shown you how transmissible the polio virus is, how quickly it can leave an infected country and go to an uninfected country and create these large outbreaks. So this is a map of the estimated fraction of children 0 to 5 that have received zero doses of polio vaccine. In a sense, it's a measure of susceptibility. The more red this map is, the more susceptible that region of the world is to outbreaks. Now, you'll notice, for example, the Horn of Africa is very susceptible, and over time, especially in the southern part of Somalia, there's been a lot of unrest and inaccessibility. It's been difficult to conduct vaccination there. So in a sense, these regions, it's not particularly surprising that this region is red. You'll also notice in Pakistan, along the border with Afghanistan, there's a tiny region of red, and that is the federally administered tribal areas where there are drone strikes, vaccination bans, a lot of unrest, and it's very difficult to access for vaccination. Now, of course, susceptibility is not risk. If you have virus in Nigeria, you have to try to understand how it travels to Somalia to understand how do I prioritize vaccination in Somalia versus Kenya versus Sudan, for example, or Senegal, or parts of the Pacific. And that's a bit of the difficulty that we face in doing this work is you may have a measure, perhaps imperfect, of susceptibility, and you have to combine it into an estimate of a programmatic action, which is a number of SIs. And this was actually done in collaboration with the partners. So we were a participating group, and we make maps of this type, and we estimate risk, but our colleagues at the CDC also do, our colleagues at the WHO also do, and we combine all these three these models into a consensus risk score and use that to determine how many SIs are conducted. Now, this was the global kind of a global view. I want to give an example of a single country to give kind of a little bit more detail about how complex the situation can be in a single country. This is the timeline of reported polio cases in Nigeria from 2004 until now. The red bars are wild type 1, blue bars wild type 3, green bars are vaccine-derived type 2, and then you'll notice there's some green squares. Those are mixed infections. So you can tell that there were quite a few infections in the early 2000s, but somehow around 2010, there was a very sharp decrease in infections. And then that was a very narrow bottleneck in transmission that the virus was able to pass through and continue circulating for five more years. There was a lot of realization in 2010 that it was going to be very important to detect polio cases very effectively, but also to anticipate them. You'll notice the number of efforts that were made to fight the virus, for example, by changing the type of vaccine that's used. MOPV1 stands for monovalent oral polio vaccine type 1. So it contains only the type 1, because when you put all three types of vaccines in the same dose, they interact in conflict with each other such that the recipient can be immunized against only one of those types. The type 2 vaccine is the strongest, so it overpowers type 1 and type 3. So making these monovalent type 1 and type 3 vaccines was such that you can make the vaccine more effective in these places. And eventually they realized they could make a bivalent, or 1 plus 3 vaccine, where the interaction between 1 and 3 was small, and use it going forward. And since then, the trivalent and bivalent have been the main vaccine used in the program. What led to what I would say a very successful last few years in Nigeria are a very significant staff surge from WHO and the UNICEF, but also the deploying of some more technology around the eradication. For example, the tracking of vaccination teams with GPS units, very detailed mapping of every village in these very remote areas to understand which village was not being reached, which village was being reached, so that you could literally vaccinate every child. A certain amount of technology and coordination, these emergency operation centers brought the partners together in a single place with the government to do to conduct this program. Now, I want to talk a little bit about one of our collaboration with the Nigerian government, which was in the mapping of the risk of polio across the north. So the north part of Nigeria has been the one who experienced the largest burden. And as I mentioned, when you have, there's very few cases that are discovered because the case to infection ratio is low. So it's difficult to anticipate cases. If you're only following cases, you're really trailing the virus. So you want to get ahead of the virus. You want to understand where are the susceptible within your very broad population. So you're, which is a kind of a very good problem to build a risk model on. So in order to do that, we wanted to look at what predictors we could use to predict where cases would be next. And what we found, what was most striking, is the best predictor was the sum of cases historically in a certain district. So a district that had a case or a lot of cases 3 years ago was could be more at risk than a case than a district which had a case just last week. And to us, that meant that the best predictor was really an indication of chronic weakness. If you've had a very large number of cases historically, that means that you may have chronic underperformance or chronic issues or chronic risk in that LGA, which is what they call districts in Nigeria. Our approach included many other predictors, for example, the zero-dose fraction that I mentioned before. And in the end, we combined it similarly to the regional models with models from the country themselves, which had a lot of in-country experience, understanding of these LGAs and what their local risk factors were, and a models created by the CDC. And altogether, we were able to achieve fairly good predictive power, better than what you would traditionally achieved with a risk model. But the issue was that our model was of limited responsiveness because it was not strongly related to indicators of that the program could change. So in order to essentially find underperformance, you needed a good measure of coverage data. And in a program like this for vaccination, you may have measures of administrative coverage, where you have an idea of how many vaccine you use per area. You may have maybe some independent monitoring. The polio program had a way to essentially sample vaccination coverage that was meant to be easy and targeted towards these highest risk areas. But there was came to light an issue which was the places that had most cases somehow seemed to report very good vaccination coverage. So if you have a measure of coverage which is not reliable or misleading, that can prevent you from finding underperformers. So in 2000, they introduced this technique called lot quality assurance sampling, which is essentially a small coverage survey of six clusters of 10 children. Very strict sampling methodology, and compared it to what the results were from their previously used independent monitoring methodology. So what the graph on the right, although it's a little bit complex, shows is the relationship between this new method of sampling and the previous method of sampling. If the two methods agreed very closely, all the color in the graph should be along the diagonal, right? If they don't agree, you could expect a lot of scatter or a bias. In this case, you can see a very strong bias that the previous method consistently reports greater than 90% coverage, which is a programmatic target, fairly independently of what the true, I'm going to use LQS coverage as a better measure here, of what the actual measure of coverage is. So there's relatively little information in what was collected before compared to this new method. You can only see this by comparing the two and matching these samples. They had an intuition based on cases that there was something wrong with their current measure. But with this new measure, which has now been scaled up to the polio-infected countries, you have more reliability and you can act more on these coverage information. Now, I want to transition closer to the end game and talk about how do we know that we're done? Right? And what is the utility of knowing when we're going to be done. So the graphs on the right show a calculated probability of elimination. That is not the probability of zero cases, the probability of zero infection as a function of time. So this is time on the x-axis. And for the three types of currently circulating viruses in Nigeria, the type 1 shows to be with a high probability of elimination right now. The type 2 is in a steep part of the probability of elimination, but it's not quite done. And type 3 is almost certainly gone. And the reason why it's difficult to estimate this is because there's so few cases per infections. And that's going to be a recurring issue as we get closer to zero because of the difficulty of certifying polio. So I'll briefly talk about vaccine-derived polioviruses. I only have a couple slides left. When you get very close to the end, when you have no more wild viruses around, what's left is what's created by the vaccine. So you know that you'll eventually have to stop using the vaccine because it will be the last source of paralysis that you have. As I mentioned, there can be vaccine-associated paralytic polio, or they call it VAP, in primary vaccine recipients that are healthy. If you're immunodeficient and you receive the vaccines, you have a much greater chance of being paralyzed. So there are immune-deficient VDPVs. And the last type, which is perhaps the most dangerous, is the circulating vaccine-derived polioviruses, which are the vaccine that reverts back its neurovirulence and its transmissibility. And this map shows kind of the number of emergences of circulating vaccine-derived polioviruses of type 2 only that have happened in the last 15 years. And you know this, there's been quite a few geographically broad. The biggest centers have been Nigeria and Congo, and some have lasted for 10 years. In Nigeria specifically, there's a cluster which hasn't been seen since last year, but is 10 years old. That is a type 2 vaccine-associated circulating virus that is circulating that country for 10 years. There's also, so the current CVDPVs now are in Mali, Pakistan, and Nigeria. There's even a CVDPV of type 1 in Ukraine right now. The unrest in that area has really taken a hard toll on the health services, and there's quite a few circulating in Madagascar. This is kind of a focus on Nigeria. You'll notice there's quite a few vaccine-derived polioviruses, and this is an example of how we might use mapping, modeling of immunity to inform the program as to how they can track and monitor their type 2 viruses. To save on time, I'll just jump to the last slide. And try to give you guys an idea of where the program is going next. So this year, it was a very interesting year. They introduced the killed vaccine and routine immunization around the world, which is part of this transition away from the live vaccine. The killed vaccine doesn't create paralysis, though it's less effective at preventing transmission. And in April of next year, there will be a removal of the type 2 live vaccine from the vaccination that's used around the world. So all the CVDPVs that I've shown you in Africa, the source term, right, in the sense the reason we have those will be removed from the vaccination policy. Going forward, hopefully we'll see in 2016 the last case of wild type 1, and we'll have a global certification, hopefully, of wild poliovirus in 2019. We'll probably see some outbreaks of CVDPVs in the beyond 2016, and eventually, as we remove all three live vaccine types of other types of CVDPVs. But if we can find a good strategy to interrupt any of these outbreaks, we have a chance to maintain the world in a completely polio-free status. There's a number of remaining research questions, which is a bit surprising considering how close we are to the end, but there's still research ongoing for polio. There's still very important questions left to be answered. For example, After we stop using OPV around the world, we'll probably still have to use it in outbreak response. And how much risk does that cause? How much OPV is too much? And how do we use the current vaccines that we have to interrupt circulation? What do we do with extended surveillance? When you don't have paralysis anymore, your surveillance system is not going to stay as strong as it is now. So you'll need ways to supplement it. And tracking poliovirus in sewers is probably going to be an important part of that. There's a lot of new data coming from trials around the killed vaccines and its ability to interrupt transmission that is currently being analyzed, and the conclusion of which will be interesting for endgame. And finally, there's still some work being done on the transmissibility of the Sabin vaccine. So that's it for me. There's a lot of people that helped putting these slides together and did the work from the IDM team side, but also our collaborators in Nigeria and Pakistan at the Gates Foundation, and of course, GPI partners. Thank you very much.
So, if you can hold your questions for Guillaume until the panel session, we'll move straight on to the next talk as we're running slightly behind. So could I invite Virginia Serra up from the International Coalition for Trachoma Control to talk to us about closing the gap on blinding trachoma.
Hello, everyone. It's lovely to be joining you today in this very full room. I've seen many people recently at a meeting of the NGDO network in Abu Dhabi, so it's great to be connecting with you again, and also to be seeing people. I guess hello to everybody who's not in the room, in whatever time zone you are. And for many colleagues who've joined us from lots of different parts of the world, we're probably all operating in all of your time zones. So let's hope we come together effectively for this time together today. My name is Virginia. I'm known to some of you in the room, but not all of you. I have a day job, which is as the Global Partnerships Executive for the Fred Hollows Foundation. I'm based here in the UK. But the job that excites me the most, can't say that to my Fred Hollows Foundation colleagues, but excites me the most about the work that I'm doing across this sector is the engagement with the work on the elimination of blinding trachoma. The International Coalition for Trachoma Control it occupies a substantive amount of everybody's working time. We're all very committed to the elimination of trachoma as a public health problem. And I'm going to share a little bit about the disease, about what we're doing, and about what excites me about that in our time together now. I won't assume that all of you know much about trachoma, but I will give you a little bit of an overview. It is the world's leading cause of infectious blindness. It affects approximately 232 million people who live in endemic areas, and almost 1.2 million of those people have irreversible blindness as a result of trachoma. So trachoma is caused by an infectious bacteria, Chlamydia trachomatis, and it's passed through contact from eye discharge between people, from infected persons via their hands, fingers, towels, sheets, anything that's coming in contact with eye-seeking flies. And it particularly thrives in areas where there's poor sanitation and limited access to water for personal hygiene. Where you've got cases of repeated infection, you can see a scarring of the inside of the eyelid, where the eyelashes turn inwards and repeatedly scratch the cornea of the eye. So every time you're blinking with this disease, you're in excruciating pain. If that active infection and cycle of infection isn't broken, that can turn to blindness for those affected people. We are very fortunate in the trachoma space to have a very well-considered WHO-endorsed treatment strategy, which looks at the surgical, antibiotic, facial cleanliness and environmental improvement components of the prevention and treatment cycle. I'm excited to say, and I think we don't do enough work on this in our space, to be celebrating some aspects of the work that we talk about. In 2014, our community was very excited to recognise that a population of 12.6 million people no longer required the treatment cycle for the antibiotic component of the active infection for trachoma. So those districts had impact assessments which illustrated that the prevalence of the disease had fallen below 5%, or the threshold for elimination as a public health problem, just to confirm the definitions we were talking about this morning. A little bit about ICTC, just a plug for the group. I'm showing you a slide of many of the member organisations in our group. It's a multi-stakeholder community of more than 44 members and observers, largely non-government development organisations, representatives from donor communities, academic institutions and training organisations, and of course the private sector. We come together to support the Alliance for the Global Elimination of Blinding Trachoma by the year 2020, and we largely advocate for the elimination of trachoma as a public health problem, but including through the very active implementation of the SAFE strategy by many of our members in support of the national programs in endemic countries. We're currently focused on the scale-up needed to reach elimination. You can imagine that 5 years out from that target, we are very busy looking at moving from a typically business-as-usual approach to a significant scale-up opportunity. We're focusing on capacity, new funding opportunities, and the implementation of initiatives which strengthen public health systems. For anybody who's interested, we have also just adopted our new strategic framework for that period, and on any of the slides that follow, you'll see our web address at the bottom. So any of the resources that I talk about, you can get through that web address. What I want to do today, though, in talking about closing the gap, and I've been invited to speak on that topic, is look at two specific examples which I think really illustrate how our sector is scaling up to close that gap for blinding trachoma. The first is a super exciting initiative, and I'm sure many people in this room are familiar with it. It's the Global Trachoma Mapping Project. And if I think about what we know or didn't know before this initiative started, I'll guide you through it. In 2011, as a trachoma community, we couldn't confirm whether trachoma was actually a public health problem in nearly 1,500 districts in the world where it was suspected to be endemic. So this particular initiative was catalysed by some funding provided by the Department for International Development here in the UK. And the aim of the Global Trachoma Mapping Project is to complete the baseline mapping for trachoma by December 2015. That's in a few months. That initiative received additional funding from many other partners, including USAID. And through that initiative, you can see that to date, it's examined more than 2.2 million people in over 1,400 health districts, involving a significant number of partners coming together, working closely with governments on their national trachoma program priorities. As a result of this initiative, we've got a significant amount of data that is ready to be analysed and able to inform program planning in 23 countries, which is impacting a population of 212 million people. This body of work has generated many things, and I'll talk about the lessons in just a moment, but it's specifically informed two ICTC partnership initiatives, one with the Queen Elizabeth Diamond Jubilee Trust Trachoma Initiative in Africa, and the other, the DFID SAFE program, also in Africa. And that has brought together a composite of funding around £80 million in nine countries, and implementing activities in hundreds and hundreds of districts in those countries. The work also obviously has been used for other scale-up grants that are made directly to ICTC members. If you're interested in the background to this particular initiative, there is much more information in the paper that's outlined in this reference on the slide. What I want to do is give you an example here of how that data and information arising from the Global Trachoma Mapping Project has been used, not only to guide scale up in Ethiopia, the country with the highest burden of trachoma in the world, but also to impact the collaborative efforts of funders and policymakers in this area. And I offer thanks to colleagues from Ethiopia who demonstrated this scale-up for trachoma at a presentation at the NNN last week. I've picked two of the slides, and unfortunately they're not dynamic. It came from a series which built the excitement to a crescendo pitch. So you'll just have to imagine that we're, you know, pitching in that way. So in Ethiopia, when I first visited maybe 4 years ago, we were looking at a trachoma program that was largely in play, well, significantly in play in one area of the country, the region called Amhara in the northwest part of the country. And more than 70 million people were living in trachoma endemic areas. So there's about 90, 95, depending on which data source you refer to, million people in Ethiopia. So that's a significant burden of the population. Through the coordinated efforts of many stakeholders within the Global Alliance in the last 3 years, and using the mapping, the data arising from the GTMP, you can see that this is the current situation. 86% of those endemic districts are now covered for programming and funding for S and A components of the SAFE strategy we were talking about earlier. And 70% of the endemic districts are covered with full SAFE based on a collaborative effort with a national campaign in Ethiopia called One Wash, which brings together a number of external stakeholders with a significant funding base behind them to tackle WASH initiatives throughout the country. So this sort of scale up is reflective of the types of initiatives that are underway in many countries. Not quite to that scale, but the intent is that we program and seek partnerships for comprehensive SAFE implementation in all endemic countries to assist national programs achieve their elimination objectives. So for Ethiopia, fantastic news, crescendo of applause. You'll see there are also some gaps remaining. So we've still got some work to do for Ethiopia. And it doesn't mean by any stretch that the trachoma burden for Ethiopia is in any way solved. This illustrates that we now have a platform to be operating at scale for SAFE implementation. So I think there's a lot of things that are encouraging and to celebrate about this particular example. But what I wanted to focus on for this session is not so much the examples, but just to familiarise them so that you can see where I'm going with this, is really to look at what the learnings are for our community, and not just the International Coalition for Trachoma Control, but the broader trachoma community. There are some key things we've learnt about moving to scale up, and I guess that's really what we're doing in this, the last couple of years, and definitely for the next 5 years. We're talking about operating at scale. And significantly, I've said it before, this is not a sort of business as usual approach. We're all operating in different ways and significantly through partnerships. So what this slide illustrates are just some of the key learnings that are emerging from our programming and partnerships. The aim, of course, of any good program of work is to try to identify and then apply as quickly as possible the learnings that we derive from these activities and apply them at a field practice level so that we can be adjusting and recalibrating efforts and keep the momentum focused on that elimination objective. And things like evaluations and operational research and the like really play an important role in generating that field-ready information, but they also significantly inform changes to policy and practice. And what's true for the trachoma space is that a lot of the substantive norms in our operating environment are subject to change at the moment. It's a very dynamic space, and we're looking at what the implications of those changes are for the next 5 years. I think some of the things that Guillaume was talking about for polio just now, in terms of the use of mobile data collection, and that David referred to earlier with partnerships and the importance of policy and advocacy, are certainly learnings that we have seen through this scale-up activities. But the key four, I guess I would really refer to, planning at scale is something that is critically different to just your everyday planning as an organisation, and it involves working very closely with other stakeholders in an open and transparent and pretty honest way about what the challenges are and how we'd overcome them. The things that have really driven us forward in our sector are the standardisation around our approaches to planning, training, engagement and implementation of preferred practices and WHO's global guidance. What that has meant is that the methodologies we're using across programs are highly transferable, and there is a lot of inter-country cooperation with a lot of trainers and planners moving between countries to support scale-up efforts in other environments. And that's been a particularly successful element to the program. I won't necessarily go through all of them because I think it's fairly obvious to say that collaboration is a key to success, and what we do together helps people to build confidence in their own activities on the ground. What I will focus on though is what we're looking at for the next steps. So what are we focusing on for the next 6 to 12 months? Within our sector, the ICTC, the coalition, we're looking at an activity to more closely identify the cost of implementing SAFE at scale and including that all-important surveillance component. It's an iterative costing, but what we knew in 2011, before this significant scale-up, and before we had data for sort of almost half the health districts in the world, what we knew about costing then is that we'd anticipated it would cost $430 million to address the confirmed burden of the disease, and that that figure could increase to $750 million if only 50% of those areas suspected as being endemic actually turned out to be endemic. So you can see that's a big costing range to mobilise funds for elimination. So we've got some information coming out in the early new year looking at a much more nuanced series of costings based on the outcomes of the Global Trachoma Mapping Project. We're also engaged in a body of work generated by the NNN WASH Working Group, and that's looking at a series of WASH and NTD indicators to try to identify a handful of universal indicators to apply across the NTD sector. And we all know what gets measured gets done, so I know that there's a lot of people eagerly awaiting that. If you are particularly interested in taking part in the Delphi study, which is guiding this body of work, please come and see me through the breaks or send me an email and I'll connect you up with the study, the folks guiding the study. We're significantly looking at the scale-up and rollout of the new F&E tools that have been produced by the coalition. And also, and I know that Dirk will be talking about this afternoon, but I'll give it a plug, the really excellent WHO WASH and NTDs strategy that's just been launched both at Stockholm World Water Week for the WASH sector and at the NNN meeting for our NTD community. So significant components around the WASH aspects of the SAFE strategy. We have a number of global consultations underway, really looking at the challenges at the end game, in that final mile. So what are we doing about trachiasis patient tracking as we start to really tackle that backlog of the surgical burden and we find the hard to reach patients? What are we doing about trachoma surveillance in that post-validation phase? Things that are critically going to affect the, as a public health problem, component of the agenda. What happens post-2020? As a coalition, we also have a progress report coming out looking at 2020 insight. It's an update on a document we published in 2012. So we'll be looking at progress since then and what we anticipate as the key hurdles and challenges in the next 5 years to the elimination timetable. So what would I want you to take away from what we've been talking about? Today, as opposed to 5 years ago, we critically know where the disease exists, thanks in part and whole to the Global Trachoma Mapping Project. So that initiative mapped around 1,500 health districts in 3 years, and it had previously taken 12 years to map a similar number of health districts. So you can see that there's a tremendous momentum being built up around that initiative. We also know how to treat the disease, both in its active form and for the ongoing sustainability of the program through the F&E components, thanks to that SAFE strategy, and thanks in part to the field learnings of ICTC members identified through a range of preferred practice materials. And again, as a plug, if you'd like any of them, the website address is at the bottom. We have a hugely committed group of stakeholders through the Global Alliance, which includes WHO, it includes representatives from the endemic countries and funding partners, pharmaceuticals, non-government organisations, academic and training institutions. We come together annually to meet and really look at what the key challenges are for the next period of implementation. We continue to generate evidence and field experience to identify where the ongoing challenges are and try to attract resources to fill the gaps around those challenges. So what I'd like to focus on just in this last few moments is really what I think we're here today to talk about, and that is that there are a number of challenges remaining for trachoma, but also I think for other disease group areas. So I would hope that we can tackle some of these in the discussions this afternoon to really inform the way that the society might put together its policy platform and think about the 4 or 5 day meeting that's on next year. And I'll summarise them like this. There is a lot of cross-learning between the disease areas. For some of us, we remain so focused on what we're doing that we forget to look outside our own disease groups. There is a lot we can learn from, I don't really want to say the failed diseases as they were referred to earlier, sorry, but the diseases that have gone before us and had the experience of trying to tackle either elimination or eradication. What can we learn from them? And for the trachoma sector, we've done a lot of work recently with the leprosy sector to learn from their experience. Really focusing on multi-sectoral engagement, and that's from the outset. One of the things that we all do, I think, is talk very effectively to each other, but we don't often talk very effectively to people in other codependent sectors. Obviously, we're very health-focused. What are we doing with the education sector, the WASH sector, the finance teams, the other sectors and health departments in countries where we work to ensure that we are collectively coming together at the outset of our programming efforts and engaging them in their language in something that they're passionate about to achieve our common objectives? I guess that speaks a little to the next point, which is making sure that we reframe the narrative for those final few miles. We can't just do what we've always done because it's been successful to a point. It has meant that we've been able to tackle the low-hanging fruit, maybe even the middle branches of the tree, but now we're really starting to get to those higher branches, the unreachable areas. So if we are to ensure that we leave no one behind, as the key tenet of the new Sustainable Development Goals, we really have to start talking about elimination of trachoma as a public health problem and not perceive it as a vertical health intervention. And I think this really speaks to what we do around the challenges for cross-border issues where there's infection across borders, because obviously populations are highly transient. And I think we saw that in the two previous presentations this morning. What are we doing about communities who need treatment engagement in highly insecure areas? So some of those really critically challenging things that have been in the slightly too hard basket to date. For us, one of the really important things is absolutely looking at who the new generation of stakeholders are going to be. What are we going to do as a sector about developing, engaging and empowering new leaders in the NTD community? I don't just mean in endemic countries, I mean in countries like this. We've relied significantly on those senior statesmen and women who've led the sector in the past, and I think perhaps it was a reflection of mine this morning that as I was thinking about the 2030 development agenda and realising I would be 60 in the year 2030, that we really need a lot of young people with passion who have the technical expertise, but also the excitement and partnership approach, who are keen on advocacy outcomes, as David indicated earlier, to really drive the development and the sustainable development agenda forward for the NTD space. And I think critically for this group of stakeholders in the room or online is what we do about bringing hard science and research into the evidence-based and influencing space. One of the things that's most exciting for me about being in the UK, and I'm, you might have picked up from the accent, I'm an Australian, I've been here for 3 years, but this sector is, this country is a world leader in generating evidence and excellent research outcomes. We really need to make sure that those outcomes are being disseminated to practical field application and policy and advocacy opportunities. If we don't do that, we're missing significant opportunities to bring more stakeholders into the end game discussions. I would hope we would talk a little bit about all of those things this afternoon. I think on that note, probably just to say thank you very much for your time and for listening to me. I look forward to engaging in sessions throughout the day, and I thank the Royal Society for bringing together the group of stakeholders to have these discussions. It's really important and I'm looking forward to it. Cheers.
So I'm going to invite our next speaker up, please, Professor Charles Mackenzie of the Liverpool School of Tropical Medicine, to talk about lymphatic filariasis elimination, a lesson in public health for chronic debilitating diseases.
Thanks. Good morning. Good morning everywhere in the world. I'm going to talk to you about lymphatic filariasis, and some of the data that I'll give you will be data from our group in Liverpool, so I just want to acknowledge them in the start. So what's happened in the last 25, 27 years, at least in parasitic diseases, is a major shift with treatment. And it was started by onchocerciasis control program that David talked about. It was started with Merck and MDP. It then moved to the lymphatic filariasis program that GSK headed. And now we have other NTDs. And this major shift in treatment is something that I want to focus on and see if we can't keep it going. And hope that, and certainly in terms of patient care, that we can use this initiative that started actually 27 years ago to try and continue getting care for all, and particularly addressing things like the sustainable development goals. One of the points about these diseases are that, unlike malaria and others, they're not killing diseases but chronic diseases. And I'm obviously focusing on chronic disabling diseases in this talk. Who are lymphatic filariasis patients? They're obviously the reason we have the lymphatic filariasis program. You know, if we didn't have patients, we wouldn't have the program. It is a very chronic and obviously disabling condition. And the patients are very central. We've tended to not work on them so much or work with them in the last 10 or 15 years from the beginning, and we're doing it more now. They are important in advocacy. People don't necessarily take the drugs unless you see you're doing something for the people that actually have the infection or have the disease. And they really are important in success, because success would be that there are no new cases. They are a classic example in lymphatic filariasis of a chronic disabling disease, of which there are others that in the NTD group, and particularly podoconiosis and leprosy, as two somewhat similar patient care issues. Establishing a long-term care for people who are affected by lymphatic filariasis is really, I think, the ultimate success, because a lot of these patients will still need care after we've got rid of the parasite, we've got rid of the cause, and these people do live in some of the most underserved parts of the world. So really, can we use what we're doing for lymphatic filariasis patients to help serving all of the disabled people? What is actually going on inside a patient, just for those that are not familiar? Essentially, what's happening where the parasite is lying in the lymphatic vessel, the lymphatic vessel actually grows. It doesn't really block. And what happens is that you actually get a much more dilated vessel, not a blocked vessel. And it's that dilated vessel which is unable to pump fluid away from the tissues and clean the fluid away. So it's actually a growth, not a blockage. At the tissue level, you get lymphatic stasis and inflammation. That results in, obviously, the tissues that it should be draining the fluid away from, degenerating, dermal degeneration. And in many patients, it reaches an irreversible point in the pathogenesis, and those patients are never going to recover back to normal. And they're, of course, the chronic disabling people that we're talking about here. Then there is the changes in the quality of life, stigma. The acute attacks that accompany this are actually the thing the patients really dislike. Quality of life, and I would say family life in particular, is also destroyed. Economic hardship and mental depression that comes with that. What is the global program? Just to fill you in on that, the aims of the lymphatic filariasis program was to eliminate it as a public health problem through really two approaches: interrupting transmission by the drugs, and then managing morbidity. I would point out that it differs from onchocerciasis, because the treatment in onchocerciasis is actually the same as the treatment of the patients. So by breaking transmission in onchocerciasis, you actually get rid of the disease. That is not the case with lymphatic filariasis, at least a majority of the chronic disabled patients. The other point I'd make here is that, in fact, everybody who is infected with lymphatic filariasis does have some change in their lymphatics. It's not as though they have nothing going on. Even children at the age of 4 do have changes in their lymphatics, which can be reversed if you remove the worm. The global program is essentially one that has these two arms: mapping, first phase, giving the drug, and then assessing that the parasite is gone, and with the patient care side, the morbidity management side, obviously developing a program and then keeping it going, and then the successful verification by WHO. So that's what the global program is. Usually it's 5 rounds, at least that's the theory. We have gone to many more rounds in other countries. TAS is just the transmission assessment survey, and of course there are other monitoring activities along the way. So let me just turn to what is success. And if we look at what has happened to date, we've got, at the inception of the program around 2000, there were predicted to be 120 million people at risk, with possibly 40 million suffering, maybe more. After 8 years, and this is all data that was released a couple of weeks ago by WHO, after 8 years, something it saved, probably $24 billion was saved by actually reducing the number of cases. So after 13 years, there have been 100 million cases prevented, and that's the prediction, with probably 36 million cases remaining. Although the number of cases is really still something that is still a bit of a guesstimate. In 2014, again, there was on the global area, the global approach, there was 73 countries endemic. 18 had reached that TAS stage. In other words, they were looking at stopping treatment. 55 still had treatment going on. And there are 11 that had not yet begun MDA in 2014. 21 of these 73 countries actually had 100% coverage, meaning all the endemic areas were really getting treatment. That means in 2014, 5.62 billion people were treated at least once. And obviously one of the biggest chemotherapeutic approaches ever attempted and succeeded, with still more to come. Some of the challenges that were also identified in the WHO article were still a perception of a low burden, in other words, a low disease level, a lack of prioritization in ministry agendas, in countries, in health agendas. It's not a killing disease. And the consequent lack of domestic investment. And one prediction is that at least the next 5 years of continuing the program would need about $154 million US. So what kind of success can one see? I've mentioned 100% geographic coverage. And these are points at which countries can actually celebrate success. And I think that's very important, to have countries actually get to some point and actually be able to say, yep, we reached that point. So 100% geographic coverage is one good point to reach, and some countries haven't even started. The stopping of MDA treatments, obviously stopping a treatment is a big plus. And then the successful submission of the WHO dossier and the actual validifying by WHO team of having actually succeeded in preventing that public health program. The one that I add now is integration of the chronic patient care into the health system. And I think that's almost the biggest challenge we have. And of course, I still like no new cases. And that's something of long-term surveillance. And how long that term is, I think, is something that still needs to be discussed. Give you a couple of examples from our program in Liverpool. Here's an example of 100% geographic coverage in Mozambique. And Mozambique was a country that a few years ago was regarded as a challenge to get things going. And you can see here over on the other side there, 2009 in red, there was only geographic coverage in a few of the pink areas, which are the endemic areas. The yellowish area is non-endemic. And by 2014, we have complete coverage of the whole country. That's a success point for a country, and a big country. Another one here in stopping treatment, here in Bangladesh, which is a very positive program. You can see in red on the other side, there are the endemic areas that have got all 100% geographic coverage. And then here, over this side, the red is the one that's still remaining and hasn't stopped treatment. So the blue areas and the green areas have at least passed one of the stopping treatment tests. So that's rapidly going towards success, and I believe will be very successful soon. I mention this because this is an important step, and this is the WHO dossier, which is really the submission to WHO that they have fulfilled the requirements of reducing their infection levels to a a level that is acceptable to WHO consultantship group. What's important about this is that we may, that there is an inclusion of a patient care need in this, and that the patient care, part two of the team, of the requirements, are involved in this dossier. And this actually gave countries something to aim for in terms of their morbidity care program. Before that, it was rather vague, and we didn't really, we weren't able to tell countries what to aim for. They needed a goal, a simple goal. This dossier goal has, which doesn't have two really very difficult things to do. They need to know how many patients they have, and they need to have care available to those patients and accessible to those patients. If they do that, then they are likely to fulfill the dossier needs. That really catalyzed in our programs a country to know where to go. And I think it's something that perhaps other chronic disabling diseases could mimic. So long-term success, really, just to repeat that long-term success to me is really after you've got rid of obvious things like the hydrocephalectomy, surgeries which one can really go ahead and get rid of the backlog, like with trachiasis, but embedding in of the provision of care into that health system of each country. And that's the most difficult thing. And that is one that I think fits into the goals of universal health coverage. And if we can use lymphatic filariasis and other chronic disabling diseases to do that, then I think we will have really pushed this a long way. So if I look at the way the programs have gone, we talked about onchocerciasis, and David mentioned all of these. The onchocerciasis program came in, lymphatic filariasis came in, and patient care is something we needed to emphasize and are doing more now. There are other NTDs that have come in, and just call this the NTD era, with either chemotherapy, environmental change, direct treatment, and other approaches. And then what I'd like to see that we have is a continuing care phase of universal care. And hopefully that will be when we really are successful as a group of eliminating disease people. So what can you do to get it to this next phase? Integrating it into the health system needs training, needs all of the things that Virginia talked about. I just want to emphasize healthcare workers because I think they're very key to this. They're active in the MDA programs for us. They know the patients and they actually can select the patients for care, and we need to empower them. And how do we empower them? Just to give you one example that we've been moving towards in Liverpool, and that is actually using mobile phone technology, and we've been using it to identify patients, management of supplies, so they can request some supplies. And actually, we haven't quite got here yet, but we want to also use at least smartphones to be able to give them up-to-date information and so they know what to do. And this is work that's come out of Louise Kelly Hope and Michelle Stanton in our group. And just a couple of images of this taking place in Tanzania, where we've trained people in using these phones, SMS first. Interestingly, a lot of the healthcare workers couldn't actually send text before. They now can, so we've empowered them there. You can get real, this is actually a study that was done in Dar es Salaam where you can see over time, you get a real time reflection of the cases that we've been following over, you can see in the graph up there, and you get a tabulated form. So what we've used this for is actually looking at Dar es Salaam to see where the patients were. And Dar es Salaam has about 5 million people, and we did a house-to-house survey there. We used 300 health workers, and we came up with just under 7,000 patients were identified using the SMS system. This Dar es Salaam is quite a challenge, as many of you that know Tanzania would know. That now allows us to focus where to put hydrocele operation centers. See here the camps on this side, or at least where to focus patient care. So this sort of technology has been very useful. We also, as I said, use it for ordering things if they need to move drugs around or to order soaps. And so it's a way of empowering the health worker. That way we get much more universal health care. The last piece I just mentioned is really integration with other NTDs. And this strengthens the healthcare worker's ability to actually serve her or his people. Lots of ways of training together, and this point's been made by Virginia about getting people together. And the mutual integration of these into the national health system is where hopefully we can go with this. So collaboration across. We have programs in Liverpool in leprosy programs in Nepal and Mozambique, and in Ethiopia with the podoconiosis group that Gail Davies works with. And I say there we're mutually appropriate. I think integrating where it actually is inhibition is not a good thing, and I'm sure we can find enough things to do together. We've mentioned the NNN group. That's an important global group to be part of. And just to give you a heads up, the term disease management, disability and inclusion is one that has been requested as a new name, which we're submitting to WHO to see if that's acceptable. So MMDP, you might soon see a DMDI, and it's not DNDI, as many of you know. So really, NNN group is a very important group in terms of getting us together for chronic disabling conditions. So the challenge is to integrate, develop the country support system. I think that's very difficult, but needs to be done, the policy part. Defining care, the science part of our title here, that's still something we can do. And the political will is absolutely essential, and advocacy, and politicians are always central to any of these programs. And then move together, we must put efforts in these areas. So I will end by saying that I think LF care, as we move forward, is an opportunity to move to these goals of universal health care, the sustainable development goals, and just general strengthening of what's going on. Lymphatic filariasis does affect both genders, even though obviously hydrocele is somewhat biased in one group, and it does affect the young. And as I said, the young do have pathology. So in summary, just to repeat what I said, this first onchopsychiatrist program sort of moved us through to the second program, which was different. It was something, originally we were based on NGOs. We focused more in the second phase with lymphatic filariasis on ministries of health. And in the new phase, we can say, you know, seize the chance to bring care to those people who do have disabling conditions. And so patients really are central for long-term future of chronic. That's an obvious statement, but sometimes we tend to forget it. And I just acknowledge many people who are part of what we're putting together in Liverpool, and particularly the group in the filariasis program support center, and the ministers of health in Tanzania, Bangladesh, and I should have added Mozambique there. Thank you.
Well, we've gone slightly over, so I'm going to ask you to go and grab your coffee quickly and drink that in the next 15 minutes and come back so we can get back to time again at 11:30. Thank you.
Thank you for joining us for this live video stream from the Royal Society of Tropical Medicine and Hygiene. There will be a short pause in the proceedings whilst our speakers and delegates here at the Royal Society break for coffee. The live stream will resume at 11:30 with a presentation by Professor David Smith reflecting on malaria eradication in the past, present and future. Do stay with us.
Professor Dave Smith, who is now at the Institute for Health Metrics and Evaluation at the University of Washington, to talk to us about Plasmodium falciparum eradication in the past, present, and future, just to keep David happy.
Thank you. So I want to start this conversation not talking about malaria, but smallpox. On the left-hand side, you see the last documented case of smallpox from the original endemic transmission that plagued the world from a very long time ago, and the declaration that came 3 years later that smallpox had been eradicated. Now, what was the, I want to ask this question that sort of Scott Barrett and others have written, but mostly Scott Barrett has asked the question, what exactly were the economic benefits of smallpox eradication? And so there were two big benefits. One was that about 1.5 million cases, deaths from smallpox were averted. And once it was done, you could end smallpox vaccination programs. That is, nobody had to be vaccinated for smallpox ever again. Well, what was the counterfactual? What were you comparing that against? Well, it was a massive international program to avert most of those deaths, but an ongoing smallpox vaccination program. So the cost savings was really that you could end smallpox vaccination. And when you take all of the costs of eradicating smallpox and add them up, and you compare it to the cost savings of being able to abandon your global smallpox vaccination program, all the costs, it turns out that about 28 days after that last case, after they could start dismantling those programs, 28 days later, the whole program had paid for itself. And then it paid for itself again, so that the cost savings ratio was about 160 to 1. That is to say, we've saved about $160 for every dollar we spent on the smallpox eradication program, which is certainly one of the greatest investments in public health ever made, or in economic development ever made. And this is a very tempting prospect. Now, it may not be that other diseases have such a high cost-benefit ratio, but it's important to note two things, that the economic benefits really did come from ending vaccination. I've said that three times now. I want to make sure that you understand that that's what the benefit was, right? So even if we eradicated measles, we wouldn't recoup a massive savings from all of that unless we could stop measles vaccination programs, for example. And it only came, therefore, after there was a last case. So once that last case was gone, there was no further risk of smallpox transmission in the wild, and it would then be okay to dissemble your programs. So the problem with this argument is that it makes it seem like eradication programs are a very risky prospect, and maybe in some cases there are. But I want to kind of address that framework for malaria and argue that I don't think it's the right way to look at malaria eradication. And I'm going to do it through a historical lens. So in particular, the first global malaria eradication program failed, which would say that it would probably be risky to try and start it again. Okay, and this gets into a bunch of questions. Why eradicate malaria, or better said, why attempt to eradicate malaria? Is it worthwhile to start an eradication program? What does the history of malaria say about the prospects for the future? And is it really a risky strategy to attempt to eradicate malaria? So if you were to separate the whole history of malaria into sort of five ages, the first age is everything before 1900. Or maybe you'd want to even separate it finer into the germ theory of disease discoveries and everything before that. But I'll start in 1900, shortly after Ronald Ross demonstrated the role of mosquitoes in transmitting the parasites. And once you knew the mode of transmission was a mosquito, you could go out and start to do control measures. And Ronald Ross himself has a book called Mosquito Brigades and How to Organize Them. So the very early 1900s. And then there were these massive efforts to go out and control. So one of the first was starting in 1904, the program for yellow fever and malaria control in the Panama Canal, led by William Gorgas. And a couple of details like this are really relevant. One is that when Gorgas took over the program, the Panama, the Canal Commission thought that they were nuts to focus on mosquitoes. They didn't actually believe mosquitoes transmitted malaria. So there was then a a decision to replace the Canal Commission, led by Teddy Roosevelt. And because that initial Canal Commission didn't believe mosquitoes transmitted malaria, they wouldn't grant a budget. So there was about a $1 million budget request, which was a lot of money in 1904. And the request was granted in 1905, and almost immediately after they started implementing these control measures, they saw a decline in the number of yellow fever cases and malaria cases. And this was seen as one of the major public health successes, that the canal construction wouldn't have been possible without it. One of the, I'm going to skip over a lot of history in that early days, some of it relevant. The main point is that in this first age, there were very, very few cases of malaria elimination from any countries of the world. But one of the great successes was not a malaria elimination program, it was an anopheline eradication or elimination program. So this is an emergency graveyard in Brazil, in Ceará, the state of Ceará, in 1934. It was built for malaria victims. What had happened was earlier, probably about 1930, a boat had introduced Anopheles gambia, the African vector, below a dam sort of in that part of Brazil, sort of coming from Senegal. And that vector, that African vector, had started to spread along the coast. And by the time somebody got around to, you know, it was observed and documented in 1930, the epidemic started, and they got around to doing something by about 1938. And by that time, it had occupied an area about the size of New England. The man they called into it, control it, was called Fred Soper. And he organized mosquito brigades with larval source management, and through a sort of military style, top-down program, they were able to eliminate Anopheles gambia from Brazil. And malaria didn't go away, but the load of malaria went back to where it was before. It wasn't an emergency like it was when that had happened. And this left Fred Soper in a position of being, one, very powerful and very sure of himself. And he said, famously, man has it in his power to eradicate any mosquito anywhere. So we're talking about the end of the first age and the beginning of the second age, the first age of eradication, where Soper is now one of the biggest people in the world. And we get this combustible combination of the end of World War II and this post-World War II enthusiasm for development. The discovery of DDT, the availability of chloroquine, which was a cheap and effective anti-malarial, and this led to the launching of the Global Malaria Eradication Program. So DDT had been known as a chemical for a long time, but its insecticidal properties were demonstrated in 1939. And it was shown in programs shortly after that if you sprayed it on the walls as a wettable powder, when the mosquitoes, after they had fed and rested on the walls, that they would die. They would absorb the insecticide through their feet as they were sitting on the walls and die. And in early stage programs, largely led by Soper, they demonstrated amazing successes with indoor residual spraying with DDT. And it were these sort of, starting from 1945 on, a burgeoning enthusiasm to launch a global malaria eradication program based on indoor residual spraying with DDT. And that was formalized by a vote of the World Health Congress in 1955, and it was directed by the World Health Organization. To show you something of what happened as a result of that program, I'm not going to specifically say all of this was the Global Malaria Eradication Program, but there was substantial progress made in malaria between 1900. That's a map. It's called the Lyshenko map. It was constructed by malaria experts to try and reconstruct what they thought was the range of malaria in 1900. And at the bottom, you see the range map of malaria in 2007. And the details of this reconstruction are found in this Nature paper. Gething and Simon are first and last authors. And this massive change was largely driven by the Global Malaria Eradication Program, but not all of it. I'm not making that claim. Just a lot of that change, that contraction of the range, happened because of that big program. By some measures, then, it was a huge success. I'm going to say that, and I hope we can have a chance to discuss that statement. But there are two things to note. One is, if it was such a huge success, why did it die in 1969? And I had asked myself this question many, many times, and it dawned on me that the death of the global malaria eradication was the death of a bureaucratic institution, and bureaucracies don't know how to kill themselves, okay? They will persist as long as possible. What actually drove that death was, and I finally found a figure that explained it to my satisfaction, these are the contributions to the special account for malaria. And you'll notice that there are four big donations made by the US Congress that essentially finance the global malaria eradication program effort. The last one was made in 1963. And guess when the hand-wringing started about how we're going to keep this program up? It started about 1965 when the budgets ran out. And so it ended by 1969. So the tale of the demise of the global malaria eradication program, many people have said it was about insecticide resistance. That was certainly a problem. That it was about drug resistance. Yes, that was certainly a problem. But bureaucracies don't die because of insecticide and drug resistance. They die because the money runs out. And so the end of the global malaria eradication program was almost certainly about money. So what followed the death of the global malaria eradication program, I'm going to call the age of neglect. Between 1970 and about 2000, it was very hard to get any money to do anything in malaria. And one of the consequences of all of this was a global resurgence of malaria that's been documented. So in sort of dealing with the problem of malaria elimination from Zanzibar, we went back and tried to reconstruct as much as we could of the history of malaria control in Zanzibar, which was marked by two previous periods and now the current period of control, followed by these big gaps of no control. And what happens is basically, you know, in the areas in the baseline studies before control is implemented, the prevalence of malaria on the two islands, this is Unguja at the top and Pemba at the bottom, were very high. The program came in and crashed the prevalence of malaria to very, very low levels, historically low levels. Then you notice nobody's really looking around. At this point, the Sultan who was in charge said, you know, my people, they're too powerful for malaria. We don't need you anymore. The program leaves and it's dismantled, the funding runs out, and malaria comes back. Not as fast as we would have thought in Pemba, but certainly in Unguja. There's a dearth of studies, sometimes very small studies, not nationally representative. And then malaria is obviously back, and the Zanzibar government appeals to the US government, and USAID comes in and they try to control malaria, didn't do nearly as well as before, declare victory and leave. And almost nobody collects data in the meantime before we find one nationally representative survey and it comes crashing down. The story here being high malaria, come in and do control, low malaria, leave, high malaria, come in and do control, bring it down, maybe not much, come in and do control well and keep bring it crashing down. When the money goes in, malaria goes down. When the money goes away, malaria comes back. So we did a survey of the literature to find all of the documented resurgence events we could find. This is a paper led by Justin Cohen at Clinton Health Access Initiative. We found 75 documented cases of resurgence, and we asked the simple question, there wasn't enough data in any of those cases to attribute it to a cause, but what causes had been attributed by others? The dominant cause in every case was a breakdown of the national program's ability to distribute, you know, the commodities. When that stopped, malaria came back. Now, there were problems with insecticide and drug resistance, but the dominant, most common thing mentioned was that the program simply stopped doing what it needed to do when malaria came back. I'm simplifying a complicated story here, and I hope you'll give me some license. But by and large, the problem is, if you were to say what kind of resistance, it was donor resistance. Or it was resistance, it was bad management. It wasn't insecticide and drug resistance that was dominating these resurgence events. The other side of this story, though, I think has been less told. And that is, in the other countries, the countries that did certify through the WHO process that they had eliminated malaria, you had a very different subsequent history. Which is to say, malaria didn't come back to those countries. So to try to find some data and document that, we went into the literature and found all of the reported cases we could of imported malaria. So these are countries that, all of these countries had certified that they were malaria free. And between 1980 and 2010, we could find some of these countries had documented the number of imported malaria cases and then the number of those that had been locally transmitted. So here on a log scale, the size of the box is the number of imported cases, and the color is telling you something about the ratio of local to imported cases. And if you get white, it means that there were no imported cases, and yellows are various degrees of, you know, they're sporadic cases. So for example, for the US, we have about 2,000 cases imported per year and about 5 locally transmitted cases per year. So if we're going to talk in the strict definition of there being zero transmission, the United States has not eliminated malaria. There's obviously still ongoing very low-level transmission. But if you translate this into a measure of number of cases transmitted per case, it ends up being about one case transmitted for every 20 cases imported on average, which means it's very, very stable elimination. So to recap, if countries didn't manage to eliminate, they saw pretty rapid resurgence. Countries that did eliminate it, they saw a very stable elimination. So a lot of what we would want to do from a strategic perspective is address this question: how do we make, you know, how do we make permanent progress? How do we do something that we can then integrate into the national health system and no longer a vertical program with its own budget item and stay where we need to be? That's sort of the big question for, I think, most of the diseases we'd like to work on. In the case of malaria, we want to know why was malaria elimination stable, because that would then direct how we would plan for a program in the future. So one of the things that the major branch points here is whether it was the malaria control programs that caused elimination, or whether there was something else that was happening at the same time, and coincidentally, we were doing those things and malaria went away. So there was certainly economic development in post-World War II, and it could have been the cause of elimination. The other thing, though, is that malaria elimination could have been the cause of economic development, which reinforced elimination. So there's this poverty trap that Jeffrey Sachs has proposed. So if malaria elimination is preventing economic development, and there are certainly lots of data documenting that, then elimination is necessary to spur economic development, and you'd want to do it as a part of a development program, not just as part of a disease elimination program. And that case could be made for, you know, all of these diseases, especially the ones that have a big economic impact on productivity or other things. It could be some of these countries had ongoing vector control, but on closer examination of most of these countries, the answer is not much. Some countries like Singapore have an infinitely funded vector control program when they need it, but a lot of the other countries in the world don't. So by and large, there's not ongoing vector control. You could have ongoing suppression of transmission by health systems, that is to say, people who get malaria freak out, get treated early, and it's in it, you know, because of the epidemiology of Plasmodium falciparum, you're treating at a time when there are no mature gametocytes, and you're not yet infectious. So you can knock out most of the infectiousness that would occur by treating very promptly, and so on. So just to bring it to the last age, from 2000 to the future, I'm going to call this the age of declarations. And I don't mean to say anything bad about it, because it's actually been an era of remarkable progress, as I'll show you in a minute. But after that age of neglect, the heads of Africa of African states got together and made what's called the Abuja Declaration, and they said, we need to prioritize malaria. And this was in an era when chloroquine resistance was rising and causing a public health crisis. Malaria got a separate treatment under the Millennium Development Goals, and there was a new call from eradication coming initially from the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. But let me show you what's happened in malaria. This is a paper that came out last week in Nature. And the story for a long time was that you couldn't do anything about malaria in Africa. Well, that's clearly not true. Here is our best map of malaria in Africa in 2000. And what we're plotting here is the proportion of children aged 2 to 10 who are infected with malaria. And here is that same map in 2015. And that's giving you some notion of how much things changed. And so that if you looked at what the distribution of malaria looked like in red in 2000, it looks like this now. This is a proportion living under each one of those endemicity classes. And you can see there's been a massive shift, and in particular, a massive loss a very highly endemic malaria in the populations of the world. This has been caused by the distribution of insecticide-treated nets, the availability of ACTs, and the use of IRS in different, you know, portions of that have been caused by each one of those interventions, on top of what looks to be a declining downward trend in malaria. This is a very positive note. It means that we can take a bite out of malaria. We can actually influence malaria in Africa. So just as a note, the Global Malaria Eradication Program did almost nothing in Africa. It was intended that soon they would go launch programs in Africa, but they actually didn't do very much. There were some small-scale programs like the one I showed you in Zanzibar and some trial programs elsewhere. And I think the intention was eventually to get around to Africa, but they didn't by the time the money ran out. Obviously, this time, if we're going to do global malaria eradication, the goal has to be a permanent solution to Africa, where most of the burden is today. And I think that the message of this paper is that it can be done. I will point out, this is one of the supplementary figures, looking at what happens after you do a bed net program and achieve some level of coverage. So prevalence on the x-axis at the baseline or before the program, prevalence 4 years later on the y-axis, and you can see how coverage at various levels bends that down, but in no cases did we actually document malaria elimination. So I don't think insecticide-treated nets are going to get us across the finish line. So what does the future look like? I don't know, but I don't think that if we want to eradicate malaria, we can rely on an insecticide-treated net program. So we need a new strategy to get us to eliminate malaria in country after country in some regional way that leads to eradication. And I'm talking about Plasmodium falciparum elimination, to be very clear, for and possibly Plasmodium vivax elimination after that, leading to Plasmodium falciparum eradication and Plasmodium vivax eradication. But that strategy needs to take into account the fact that we can, by spending money and spending it in the right way, permanently shrink the map of malaria. That does seem to be what the data tell us. And that if we try to rely on control as a strategy, at some point it's likely the money will run out and malaria will come roaring back and be resurgent in these areas if we have a sharp drop off in funds. So I think as a way forward, it seems to me to be sensible to think about a global malaria eradication program, but we should be very strategic about it so that we don't have this catastrophic loss of funding as they experienced in sort of 1970 when all of a sudden all the enthusiasm for malaria eradication went out the door and there was a sort of an age of neglect. That's my message. Thank you.
So thank you, Dave. Could I invite Professor Chris Whitty from the London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine to give our last talk of the morning. Easier to call for than to achieve, political and technical pitfalls in eradication attempts.
Thanks. Well, my talk follows quite naturally from the last one. The thing which is going to run through all of this is optimism bias. Most people who call for eradication have extreme versions of optimism bias, and I'll explain why that's specifically a problem in eradication in a way that it is not in others. Lots of people say you should be optimistic. I'm personally extremely optimistic about multiple things, and without optimism we would never start, but with false optimism we will definitely fail when it comes to eradication, and there's a lot of false optimism out there. Now, eradication is clearly, in essence, very simple. By our efforts in our generation, and you can make this very, very emotive if you wish to, we will spare all future generations. Fantastic. Invest now, save for all time. Now, a lot of the economic analyses of this, I have to say, are advocacy, not science. But nevertheless, there are some examples where it is true, and I think smallpox is a very good example, clearly a fantastic investment. So when chosen wisely, it makes sense. It clearly motivates, involves and excites people who are not normally in public health. So a lot of people came into public health, Rockefeller actually is probably one of them, drawn in by the excitement of being one of the people involved in eradication. The extraordinary engagement, remarkable engagement by the Rotary clubs internationally, for example, in polio eradication. These are people who wouldn't necessarily otherwise be in public health. So this can have some very positive political issues as well. And epidemiologically, it's also very straightforward. You must have R0, force of transmission, below 1, everywhere for long enough to get there. That's it. There's really, I mean, one can overcomplicate it, but that fundamentally is all you have to do. The problem with eradication is that the early attack phase always works. If it doesn't, you're definitely going to fail, and you'll fail fast. But if you, you know, unless you've done a really stupid idea, it's going to work. The problems all start in the tail end of this, and this is in the tail end, at the final bit, the final mile, as people keep on saying, but actually it's usually final at many thousands of miles, that takes you from very good control over the line to a point where everywhere R0 is below 1 and is being eradicated. That is where the problems occur. And the reason that is a problem is people who plan eradication attempts and are optimistic are doing so up here. So they're very optimistic, and they don't get hit by reality in the first few years, because in the first few years everything goes right. And it keeps on going right, really till quite near the end. And then I'll explain why it is that then the end becomes problematic. It is very clear, and many of the general lessons I'm drawing are from the multiple previous attempts at eradication which have failed. I've written just a few of them here. There are many. It's very clear that we have tried and failed on several occasions. So let's start off with a few of the ones which are partial successes, and then explain why they're problematic as individual diseases. And this is to illustrate the point that every disease throws up its own particular problems. And then I'm going to talk about some general problems which are, in a sense, universal to any eradication attempt you try anywhere. Let's start off with the leprosy eradication campaign. Terrible disease. No doubt getting rid of it would be a phenomenal way forward. And a decision was made to eliminate it as a public health problem in 1991. And this was defined, as I've written up here, as 1 per 10,000 cases. The prevalence is what we were going for, and the prevalence fell dramatically. We reached our goal by the year 2000. Great. Problem is, the incidence did not. And so what you had is a situation where the prevalence fell dramatically, but the incidence actually, in many countries, Brazil, India, for example, basically was hardly changed. How do you explain this as an epidemiologist? And the answer is, the way that prevalence was defined, the way that cases were defined, meant it was very easy to collapse because of prevalence. Anyone who was on treatment was essentially removed as a case. You cleaned out all the old cases. You redefined, there were multiple redefinitions, each one of which made it more and more difficult for someone to be a prevalent case, till you get to the point where you're extremely near zero. These do not actually affect incidence. Now, there was a real achievement in terms of elimination in the leprosy campaign. That was, it almost entirely managed to eliminate research and political will and money, because everyone had been told that eradication was coming, that it was almost there, and everyone else thought, okay, we'll take the money we're giving to leprosy and we'll put it elsewhere. The effects on leprosy research and on leprosy control have been dramatic and bad. So that's the first example. If you want to go through the details of this, I'd recommend an excellent paper by Rodriguez and Lockwood, recently in the BMJ, just going through some of the failures of the leprosy campaign. Or yours. Yours was mentioned earlier on. There was, an initially successful campaign to eradicate yours. And to some extent, it worked pretty well. Firstly, there were a number of technical problems people had not actually picked up early on. For example, they'd not picked up latency early on. And secondly, we had the usual problem that when we get close to zero, people get disinterested. Money dries up, and then you get a resurgence. And I'll explain politically why that is at the end, and I've got a slightly different take from the last talk. We do have better drugs now, we have better diagnostics, but for reasons I'll come on to, I don't think that necessarily spells that we're going to be successful if we try to eradicate yours. And then guinea worm. Guinea worm will be a successful eradication campaign. It's a horrible disease. enormous collapsing of cases, as the first speaker, for those who hear then, pointed out, we're now down to 126 cases in the last year. But I'd like to make two points about the guinea worm eradication campaign, and to be clear, DFID, for whom I work, although I want to be really clear that I'm not speaking for them in this is a personal view throughout this talk, has put a lot of money behind it, and rightly so, I think. The first is, we came across a new reservoir of infection that we were not anticipating at the beginning. This is going to be true in many potential alternative diseases. You don't see these right till the very end, when something odd happens to the epidemiology, and then you start looking for them. But the second point I'd like to make is, we're spending at the moment probably in the order of about £30 million a year on this campaign for 106 cases in the last year. If you think about it in terms of cost per case averted, that's a huge investment, only worthwhile if you're going to get to the end successfully. If you don't, that is an extraordinarily inefficient allocation of resources that could be used elsewhere. And the reason people still invest in this is we think getting to the end is a realistic bet. So those are just some examples from individual cases. Some examples from individual cases of the kind of problems that can occur, and every disease throws up a particular set of technical challenges. But there are some generic issues which are going to be true for all diseases as you come near the end. The first of which is, you move from a situation where the disease is everywhere to a situation where it's in islands that get smaller and smaller and more difficult to find. And very many of these islands may have transmission rates that are just as high as they did at the beginning of the campaign, able to sustain it in multiple little pockets, whilst around them is a sea of areas which are not there. That becomes problematic, and inevitably these tend to be in marginalised areas, difficult to reach areas, or areas of political instability. By definition, that's where these will be. So they may be quite difficult to find. The second one, which of course is well known, is that you are deliberately creating extreme selection pressure on the organism you're trying to eradicate. Therefore, you're accelerating any process of wishing to actually, if there's a possibility to evolve around the drug, the vaccine, or the insecticide you've got, this will really put pressure to accelerate that process. And that we did see that in the first malaria eradication campaign. And thirdly, new modes of transmission and new reservoirs will often be found. You know, I suspect there are, for example, mosquitoes passing on malaria in Africa we're not even aware of, and we will only become aware of when we get to really low levels, which will mess up our calculations to how we can do it. Now, one of the things that I think unfortunately doesn't help us is that there are a lot of extremely optimistic modellers out there, and they're optimistic about three things: getting money for their models and publishing them. They're optimistic about their own phenomenal powers of abilities to foresee the future, and they tend to actually have optimism biases built into many of their models. The problem we have with the end game, I'm talking about modelling it before you start, is it'll end up being multiple islands of different transmission you don't know where, with modes of transmission you probably don't know as well, and the majority of the problems, as I'll come on to, are going to be social and political, which are very difficult to model epidemiologically anyway. So I've always found some of the more optimistic things that it is possible to model the end game from the beginning surprising, to be honest. And the trouble is that because you've got a model that tells you you can do something, that reinforces your optimism bias that it's possible. So I'm not sure these are altogether helpful in public health terms. Alongside that, there is a real risk to any really realistic eradication or elimination campaign of eradication or elimination cannibalism. If you look at the history of the smallpox eradication campaign, successful, it was almost derailed on several occasions by the concurrent malaria eradication campaign. If you read the memoirs of D.A. Henderson, who did that, this becomes extremely clear. And actually, every time you look at eradication campaigns, what you find is that there tend to be competitions. And the competitions are for obvious reasons. The same donors are putting money at the top of the pipe, and the same people are delivering it at the bottom of the pipe on the ground. In between, there may be very stovepiped individual eradication programs, but at the top and the bottom, you've basically got the same people. And that's made worse, I think, to predict by the fact that many eradication campaigns start off synergistic. So, for example, a filariasis eradication campaign and a malaria eradication campaign would look very, very similar when you're in the attack phase, because they're both going to be targeting mosquitoes, amongst many other things. But as you get closer and closer to the end, their needs and the demands they'll put on the public health system will begin to diverge. So running several eradication campaigns, I think, is something we should be very cautious about. And the reason I make that point is this. Why is it that there's such an enthusiasm for using the words eradication or elimination simultaneously in multiple diseases? And the answer, I'm afraid, is money. There has been an assumption by many advocacy groups that if you use eradication, and that shows you're bold and enthusiastic, you will get more money than if you don't. But if we try to do all of these simultaneously, that would, I think, be a real strain on the donor and the delivery systems of many of the countries we're talking about. And I think this is really the first political point I'd like to make. Single disease advocates are often enthusiastic about calling for eradication. My view is they should fear it very greatly. By definition, if you call for eradication, you're asking the world to overinvest in your disease compared to every other disease. That is what you're asking them to do. You're basically asking them to take money away from other public health concerns and give it to you. It gets your disease talked about, you appear in the media, you tend to attract a certain amount of research funding. That's the good, that's the front end, that's when you're doing your early attack phase. But at the end of it, and this is a point the last talk made really well, the money dries up. And if the money dries up and you've failed at the point the money dries up, this is seen as an abject failure and people will not believe you again for a generation. This is what we found with malaria, what we found with yours. Eradication is only sensible to call for if you really care about a disease, if you're guaranteeing you're going to succeed. If not, the promise of eradication, even if you get very considerable success, as with the first malaria eradication attempt, is seen as a failure, and that leads to a disinvestment of an irrational sort. And the reason, and this is my gloss on the last talk, which I very much enjoyed, is there is a political paradox to eradication. It is most popular where it is least realistic. If you ask a minister of health in West Africa, would you like to eradicate malaria, they will say yes without any hesitation. For them, this is the primary thing that their families are concerned about, the families who vote for them are concerned about. In West Africa, we are a very, very long way away from eradication. We can get rid of almost all the deaths now. We know how to do that. But eradication, we are a very, very long way away from, for perfectly good epidemiological reasons. Latin America, technically, we could eradicate, or we could eliminate locally. But you won't find many ministers of health in Latin America talking about that because they do not see the point where they are. So there is a mismatch between the enthusiasm and the technical possibility. And that geographical mismatch is actually compounded by the political paradox in terms of time. At the beginning of an eradication campaign, people are very enthusiastic. They see a huge problem. Then you start to succeed. People remain very enthusiastic at this point because the disease is dropping very, very fast. By the time you get to here, the disease, for perfectly straightforward mathematical reasons, leaving aside anything else, is now dropping very slowly in terms of total numbers. The rate of change may be the same, but the numbers are going down relatively slowly, and other disease priorities have moved up relative to your one. So this Minister of Health retires very happy. This Minister of Health retires also very happy. This Minister of Health is going to have other people clamoring about the fact, why are you not giving stuff to pneumonia? How about all the diarrheal disease? So this Minister of Health only inherits a problem to which they see an endless solution, and yet this bit of the curve actually costs more than this bit. If you're a politician, that's an extraordinarily unappetizing situation to find yourself in. So eradication campaigns will only work if they can move from here to here in a short enough time, people basically can remember the beginning of them. If it's going to go on a very long time, you are politically dead. Would be my advice as someone who has to work on the political and science interface. And adding to that, there are very substantial social and political risks of the endgame, as the recent tragic deaths around polio, for example, demonstrate very clearly. Because one of the things you get is, as you get to the end of an eradication campaign, groups of people who you didn't know about start saying, we don't, you're not in our name, we don't support you in this. It may be because they always were against it. It may be because they see external interference. There may be political mischief making. But for whatever reason, you will get groups who are resistant, and they will tend to be in the very areas where you've got the most problems. And polio demonstrated that very clearly. But if you look at the history of, for example, the smallpox campaign, you find there was also deep dislike of the smallpox campaign and actual violence, and there was also in the malaria eradication campaign towards the end, as certain groups who really had never bought into it found themselves being impacted. So this is quite problematic, and one of the things we found with polio, for example, is that it's extremely easy to weave conspiracy theories into eradication campaigns, because what you see is a huge amount of effort around a disease that no one's seeing, and everyone says why. And it's then extremely easy to turn that narrative into one where, instead of these wonderful people who are trying to eradicate this disease, it's these people who don't care about our problems, they just got their own problems, and this becomes a politically very toxic mix. Finally, on to this point about sticky control and elimination that was raised very well in the last talk. Elimination is politically much lower risk if it is sticky. So if the point you get down to when the politics or the money runs out is where you stick, then actually the risks of that are quite low, because you've done a huge advantage. The area under the curve is going to look very satisfactory. If, on the other hand, it's going to bounce back up again, that's going to be problematic. Now, you can, to some degree, predict where things are going to be sticky, and you can basically predict it by roughly what the R0 force of transmission is at its natural state. If it's around about one, it'll come down quite a long way. And I'm talking in very broad terms here. You know, there's more subtleties to this. If it's 100, as it is in some areas for malaria, for example, then as soon as you take your foot off the gas, it's going to bounce back up again. So it should be possible to predict where elimination may be sticky, in which case I think the political risks are relatively low, and where it is very unlikely to be sticky, in which case the political risks are extremely high. And then there are some additional issues around, is the area you've cleared, for example, like to have reintroduction, have you other ways in which you can shift the R0 permanently below one, in which case you will succeed. So I'd like to finally, before I just draw my conclusions, end up with a quotation from D.A. Henderson. I think it's worth taken seriously, because he is the only man who can be said to have led a successful human disease eradication campaign. And what I put on the screen is what he said. I believe it is critical we should not be blinded to a range of new public health program paradigms by staring too fixedly at the blinding beacon of a few eradication dreams. So eradication, which I have to be clear, I am very keen on, but keen on it being successful, can mobilize new enthusiasm, it can lead to new tools. Guinea worm eradication, for human disease at least, will succeed. Polio will if we can sustain the long haul. And the excitement around malaria eradication has undoubtedly led to new thinking. These are all fantastic gains to the field. But trying and then failing to have eradication is costly, pulls resources from other priorities, tends to breed cynicism, and can destroy control programs. And there are good examples for each of those. I think it's fair to say, if you look at the history of eradication campaigns, that anything that can go wrong will. That's always a sensible planning assumption. And that political enthusiasm will, for the reasons I've given, completely logically evaporate as you get near the end point. That is just going to happen. And you've got to be able to see a way through that, because it's an inevitability. So my conclusion from that is, by all means go for eradication, but don't call for it when we can't do it. And for most diseases, we can't. But once we are there, we have to be committed with determination, organisation, stoicism, very deep pockets, because it always costs a lot more than the people originally planned it think it's going to, innovation, flexibility, particularly towards the end. And I think this is one of the interesting things about eradication campaigns, is the attack phase, you do the same thing really well everywhere. The end phase is about a series of small tactical battles where you have to do different things in different places. And that's a complete change of mindset that many eradication campaigns have failed to achieve, and flexibility. Thank you very much.
Could I ask all our speakers from this morning to come and take a seat, please? And I'm afraid one of you will have to stand.
I'm taking the privilege of being here first.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. Okay, so you've all got seats. So if we could open it up for the panel discussion and the questions that you weren't able to ask throughout the talks this morning. And again, if you could please wait for the microphone.
Thank you very much. Yale Velleman from WaterAid. David said I need to bring up water and sanitation, so I will in a minute. Virginia, you were very modest in your presentation by saying that the trachoma elimination effort is learning a lot from other eradication and elimination efforts. I wonder whether there's quite a lot that other efforts can learn from trachoma, which maybe hasn't come up strongly enough. And if Guillaume was on the panel, I would probably be directing the question to him. With the polio eradication campaign, it's taken, I think, much longer than a lot of people have anticipated. And I would say that given the challenges with the efficacy of the vaccine, which is probably due to gastro infections like environmental enteropathy, and with the cause of transmission through the fecal-oral route, working together with broader sectors such as water and sanitation to deal with that would have maybe been one of the solutions that should have been looked at by the global eradication effort and weren't. So maybe the question to the rest of you who are there on the panel, what can we learn from the way trachoma is looking at it at the moment, which is looking at treatment and prevention and very much positioning trachoma not as a single disease effort, but as an opportunity to reach unreached populations with basic services like water, sanitation, healthcare services overall, to address the determinants of disease and not just dealing with that particular issue and thereby engaging other sectors in the cause. Thank you.
Well, I think Yale said it perfectly well. I don't know that I can add anything to those fabulous words. Certainly in the trachoma sector, we've worked incredibly hard to look at co-mapping for trachoma and yours in a number of locations. We are constantly looking at how we can undertake MDA initiatives with multiple disease engagement opportunities. And I think it's a key priority of ours, as you've said, Yale, to really look at how we can undertake any of our activities in close alignment with other disease priorities. We certainly do not want to be pursuing a vertical disease agenda. And I think it came through in a number of presentations this morning. The importance of our work is really focusing on strong health systems to ensure that we can address the ongoing incidents as part of the public health system priorities. So, yes, you said it perfectly, completely supportive. Big ups to that.
I can add to that. I agree with you. Yes, we have to integrate. Some of the problems or challenges, maybe you could call them, we've run into with LF is things like timing of treatment. They're not always the same for the diseases. Another one that's come up with LF is surgery, and it's sort of obvious there are two surgical interventions there. And they probably can be done together, but often the surgeons who are doing it are different ends of the body. You know, sort of eye surgeon versus a urogenital surgeon. It doesn't mean they can't put it together, but they're challenges to doing it. I think it's a good thing to do, and we have to work harder.
Yeah, I think when you look at where people are dying of malaria, not in terms of sort of geographically, but within a country, it's very clear that the further away the further it is to get to a health center, the more likely you are to die of malaria. So draw a line sort of an hour away travel time from a health clinic of some sort, and all of a sudden mortality rates from malaria start going up. I think it's an overstatement to say we know how to fix that, because the problem is in very rural, sparsely populated areas, it's hard to provide very good health care close to where people live. It's a barrier in the United States, for example, where we have some very rural populations who are, say, Alaska, very underserved, and they have the same kinds of problems. So just saying that we're going to build up health systems and somehow get rid of the problem ignores the fact that rural populations are very hard to serve with primary health care. And that's one of the things that we could solve if we could try to build up better access to care by extending our health system through community health workers or other services. And that might be a permanent long-term solution. But we know that if we had good health care, we would get rid of a lot of these problems, but we don't know how to get good health care to them. So.
Can I comment? I think that's incredibly important, and I think one of the incredible success stories for the case study in Ethiopia that I was pointing to this morning is that there is a tremendously empowered community health worker program and health development army in that country that is mobilised for all NTDs, and it's really the government, the Federal Ministry of Health, is prioritising comprehensive planning for its NTD program, and it's largely going to be off the back of that that empowered health development army. I absolutely agree.
Please. Thank you. Wynne Guthridge, Medicines for Malaria Venture. The message I got, or one of the messages I got from Chris very clearly, was maybe we are trying to do too many elimination programs at once now for the issues that you described. I'd be interested to know from the various panel members, where do each of them think then that focus should be? We can't do them all, which are the important ones?
Don't look at me.
You said it.
I think that my view is that we have currently got two elimination campaigns, one large, one small, polio and guinea worm. I would be I'd be very much cautioned against people trying to add more large programs until at least polio is finished, and to have a guinea worm sized program in the same place you've got guinea worm. So I think that large programs, you have to basically, I don't think you can run two at once. I just don't think it's sustainable. Small programs you can, provided they don't interfere with one another. So you could, for example, you know, it's geographical dissimilarity really that would make it possible. So I think if you work through those principles, I think it's pretty obvious which ones what you're going to do next, which is a few of the more geographically focused areas. And onco is actually a good example. Happens not to be terribly coterminous with guinea worm, leave aside the ones which actually are going to be in the same place or going to take a lot of resources.
I think you made a great point about the importance of seeing the people at the top of that funnel and the people at the bottom of that funnel being the same groups of people. So certainly the challenges around donor fatigue and those resources available at the community level are real concerns that we have to look at comprehensively, and there's certainly challenges facing ministries of health in the endemic countries.
And I'll just add one other comment incidentally. Politicians, when you use the word eradication, elimination, or elimination as public health problem, they hear the same word.
Yes,
they think you
agree.
Have promised them the disease will be gone, yes. And often they think they've been promised the disease will be gone on their watch. And that's not their fault, that's our fault, that we are not clear about this. We do that because they like the message, and that's not helpful at all.
Yeah, I'm not going to advocate for my own area, but I think one of the things we can do is bring perhaps onco and LF programs together more and bring those, just because they're somewhat similar in terms of the disease, the drugs that are being used. So that would reduce the number by one.
I think it also speaks to the importance of those cross-sectoral issues, looking at really the engagement around WASH, disability, inclusion, disease management aspects, which are common to all of the diseases that we're working in. So rather than continuing to talk about any individual disease, let's look at the commonalities and see how we can strengthen health programs through those two levels of interventions consistently across the board, I think.
Judy.
Thank you.
Judy MacArthur-Clark. I think my question actually builds on where Wynne was, but comes at it from a different direction. And perhaps it's the pessimist in me, but I really enjoyed Chris's presentation. It was very practical. And it seemed to me it was talking about human behavior right the way through. And so in terms of thinking the totality of good that we can do in the world, would we be better having a large number of control programs and not try to eliminate? In other words, focus the research and everything more towards how do we get through that fantastically productive actives phase that you talked about, get to a point where we actually say this is as far as we're going to go. And what the research has actually led us to understand how we can make it sticky and we can hold it there. And would that not do more good for more people around the world? And I'd really be interested in, well, Chris's comments, but others also.
I absolutely agree with that. So to me, the logical thing to do is to have serious control, sustainable control measures. Sometimes we'll get so close to zero, we think, actually, we can push on now and do it. But there'll be other times when we can't do that. That's fine. You haven't lost anything by doing that, and you'll have saved a lot of morbidity or mortality, depending on what you're heading for. But if you claim you're going to do eradication right from the beginning, then you'll be seen to have failed even if you don't go all the way. So that seems to me a mistake. So I think that would be the way I personally would do it. And you may be able to do that sectorally, geographically, over different places and have a kind of rolling program where this works.
So I'm going to go the other way on this and say, first of all, we don't understand why things were sticky. And we could argue about it endlessly, but part of the problem is we didn't design the studies from the get-go to try and figure out why we got a lasting effect of a global malaria eradication program. We simply observed that we had one. And now we have to use historical methods, which are softer, necessarily softer, to go back and try and figure out. Second, it's not at all clear that we could have gotten to a sticky endpoint had we not tried to eliminate with that sort of very vigorous surveillance attempt at the end. And I might even argue that it was the surveillance attempt at the end, at building up a surveillance system so that it was good enough you could convince a skeptical WHO board that you had eliminated malaria, that made the health system develop to a point where malaria would not come back. So I will also argue, there's been a lot of debate. I love Laurie Garrett's vertical versus horizontal essay in Foreign Affairs Journal. But there's another point, which is that you can use vertical programs to develop basic health system services. And if you do that, you have these what are called diagonal effects. And that might be the best way to solve many problems all at once. If you can design your program in such a way that it brings health systems development to the areas that need it most through some kind of, you know, service that's by design going to have cross-sectoral effects, then that might be the best way to do it. And it might require a call for eradication to get it done, even if you don't succeed in the end.
I don't agree with that. Fundamentally, I think there are many areas where we know that the natural epidemiological set point is so far above one that actually a bounce back is virtually certain unless you can get, you know, make sure there's no reintroduction. Now, there are other areas. If you look to places like Europe, malaria after the war, southern USA, it was much closer to one than, let's say, northern Nigeria is at the moment, much closer at that point in time.
I'm going to say we actually did our best to look at this in that sticky paper, which was a philosophical transactions paper. And it's very hard to make that argument. In the southern US states, people say that transmission was lower because it was further north and there was a season where you didn't have the mosquito and yada yada. But in the Sahel, you have a very long period with no transmission as well. Prevalence of malaria in some of the southern states was as high as 80% in children when they last looked in 1934 and 1935, which is the last time we had good cross-sectional blood surveys. So I don't actually find a lot of credibility to that argument, but because the data don't support it, as far as I can tell. Yeah. And so, but we can have this argument. But I will agree with him.
Start with a bit of entomology.
There is a point.
Entomology will help you to understand why you're wrong.
No, I actually do entomology. There's a point where I agree with him. But it's also, look, Singapore has had lots of malaria cases introduced very recently, where within a few days, one undetected worker from India spread it to 20 or 30 different people in these small outbreaks that were then contained. And Singapore is very unusual because they will throw unlimited resources at it. But the message is that in Singapore, at least, we would, if it were like Africa, we would say it was far to the right of that line where it was certainly going to come back. But they've made it unlikely to come back because they have such a devoted health system. So where you draw that line is not just a matter of the vector, it's a matter of the health system and how developed it becomes. And I think that's part of the story here. It's not a one point, it's an interaction between the vectors and their competence and the health systems and all of the resources you're willing to throw at something.
So not wanting to get us completely focused or stay completely focused on malaria, I'm gonna ask for one or perhaps accept one last call, and then we're going to get the panelists from this afternoon, or the conveners of the parallel sessions this afternoon, to come up quickly before you all go to lunch and tell you what they're going to be, and essentially make the elevator pitch as to why you should go to their particular session. So, Simon.
Hi, Simon Cathcart from Public Health England. We've heard lots about the success story of smallpox. I wonder if there was, you know, what lessons we can learn from that, or have things changed too much politically, historically, and whether or not scientifically that that example cannot be used in our current day's activities towards elimination and eradication.
Okay, I mean, I think there are multiple lessons to learn from the smallpox campaign. I think anyone who tries eradication without having read Henderson's book and going through the history is missing a trick. I would take one single one, which I said before, but I think it's worth repeating. You've got to move from a monolithic campaign where you do the same thing everywhere to a series of small tactical campaigns at the end point. And that is absolutely critical. If you don't do that, you're going to fail. And the trouble is, the whole machinery has been built around the single message, the single methodology. And that has to be dismantled and built in a completely different way for the final push.
So I want to, a personal story about D.A. Henderson. So we wrote a paper for The Lancet, and it was one of these special issues. So we had these public reading of the criticism. And the critique we got from Simon, will have to help me if I get some of the words wrong, is that we should take our manuscript, burn it, crumpled up, burn it, throw it into trash can, throw away the ashes, and never let anyone see it again. So he was obviously a big fan. I'm paraphrasing. And he went on to say that the reason, so we had done a technical and operational feasibility assessment for the countries of the world based on our best guess of how, you know, a couple of measures of how good the health system was functioning and a couple of technical measures of how much malaria was there. And his point was that smallpox eradication had succeeded or failed not because of the technical difficulties but because of the leadership of the people in countries, and that the leader made all of the difference in the world. That if you have a good leader, you can overcome any technical or operational problem, and if you don't, then you can find the simplest problems impossible to overcome. So there, it's obvious that there is a human element to all of this, and I don't know how to fix that. Certainly it's not a scientific matter, but one we should take into account as scientists.
I can only support what my other two colleagues have said completely.
Just to address the point of not staying on the same direction towards the end of the programs, that's going to be the case with the filariasis. In other words, ONCO and LF will be looking at hotspots, looking at a change in approach, probably different chemotherapeutic approaches, different geographic approaches. So that lesson from smallpox is one that I think filarial disease is already taking.
Okay, well, I'm going to ask you to thank our panelists. Okay, so we have one last question, which is going to go to Chris, which we've asked to come off the Twitter feed, although I suspect it might get battered back to me. Modelling is often mentioned in the same breath as mapping. While taking the point that the former is difficult, how can we improve disease maps for malaria and guide further interventions, especially in pre-elimination settings? For all the panel, but especially Chris.
Well, I am actually good about it, back to you, but just the comment I'm going to make is modelling is very different from mapping, and I think without maps you really are, you are literally moving around a map, and that's a big mistake. So mapping, I think, is critical. I certainly think, for example, the trachoma map has really made things possible that were not possible without, and it's not based on modelling, it's simply data. But you're the right person to actually answer that question.
So we haven't specifically had any talks on mapping today. It's something that obviously is close to my heart and is something that we work a lot on. In pre-elimination settings, there's still a lot of work to be done on what the right metrics are. And presumably, yes, this is specifically in relation to malaria. I think in all control programs, when you're trying to monitor and evaluate, in all elimination and or eradication programs, if you don't know where your public health problem is, then you're really not doing very well at all, and you can't really start. And I think we've seen in basically all of the presentations that we've seen today, the importance of essentially knowing the spatially and temporally the problem that you have to deal with is all important. And if you don't have that as the baseline, you don't even know what impact you're having along the way. So there's a rather biased support for mapping there. Dave?
I'd just like to make the point. A map is a model. Let's not kid ourselves. You get the raw data and you assemble it, but when you try to present that to somebody, what you're presenting them is not the raw data, it's a model of what you've done. There are inevitable gaps in the data that you fill in, whether it's by coloring something or doing something else. So there's two steps. One is the data aggregation and pulling it together, and next is the analysis of the data that precede making a map. So no map is the truth, even though, you know, we get our road maps and we believe them. They're not the truth, they're a model.
Dave.
Sorry.
So I will draw it to a close there on that happy note. Can we thank our panelists both for some excellent talks today and for stimulating some discussion, which will go on this afternoon in our parallel sessions. So if we can thank our panelists and get our conveners to come up.
So thank you for joining us at the Royal Society of Tropical Medicine and Hygiene for today's event. If you want to find out more about the Royal Society of Tropical Medicine and Hygiene, including details of other forthcoming events, please visit rstmh.org or follow at rstmh on Twitter. We hope you enjoyed this live video stream and look forward to welcoming you to future events at the Royal Society of Tropical Medicine and Hygiene.